Flag is dropped on the play, and he will not pick up the first down. Marquavius Princeton, who's a kid out of Atlanta, made the tackle.
And we got an offside on Georgia Southern here. Good to see Kyler Neal back out on the field, been banged up. He's their hard-nosed short yardage runner.
Offside, defense number 24, 5 yard penalty from the previous spot, results in a first down.
That's Sean Freeman, the safety, who was offside on the play. So it negates the big defensive stop by the Eagles on fourth down and gives the Panthers a first down at the 29-yard line.
And already in this game, on that play, you see head coach Tim Lapano's effect on the game. As a Georgia Southern, Tyson Summer, he doesn't know what coach Lipton will do.
Glenn Smith gets the handoff. Smith has a big hole. Glenn Smith runs to the pylon and gets there for the touchdown. Glenn Smith rushes 29 yards for the score, and the Panthers take a 6-0 lead on their opening drive.
Tim Lapano has come out here and putting the hands of into Glenn Smith. What a play. Part-time running back, part-time receiver. Big play right there for Georgia State to get this game started.
Rohier Tinton-Lohaus on for the PAT. He converts. In less than 3 minutes into this ball game, the Georgia State Panthers drive 75 yards. Glenn Smith with the 29-yard touchdown run to put Georgia State on top in their rivalry game. 7 plays, 75 yards for the Panthers. Nicely executed drive for Georgia State on their opening possession. Glenn Smith taking it in from 29 yards out.
On this play, Glenn Smith, who most of his time he's playing receiver, right here just cut back. And then it's just poor tackling by Georgia Southern. Poor angles, poor tackling. Glenn Smith, we know he has home run ability at the receiver spot right there, showing you at the tailback back spot he can make plays happen. And those are kind of plays that he might have to step up in this game with so many injuries at running back for Georgia State.
Glenn Smith had a big game down in Statesboro last year when Georgia State handed Georgia Southern their worst home loss ever, 34-7. That's the irony in this young series, is that both home teams in the first two meetings got blown out on their home field.
And when you look at this, Coach Lapano, his effect is already there, because how do I scout if I'm Tyson? So I don't know what kind of style of offense will come out of here, what kind of plays. Yes, your base offense is going to be the same, but when they might go for it on fourth, or what kind of trick plays is up Coach Lapano's sleeve, Georgia Southern will have to learn on the fly.
Brandon Wright will kick off for the Panthers, and Quan Howard will retreat to the goal line to take it. Howard on the return, and Howard's going to be stopped at the 16-yard line. Tackle made on special teams by James Traylor. And so the Georgia Southern Eagles will go on offense from their 16-yard line. I know they're happy to get Kevin Ellison back. Seth Schumann, the freshman, started their last game two Thursdays ago against UL Lafayette, and they had to throw the ball a lot because they fell behind, but they hope with getting Kevin Ellison back out there that they can get back to running their option offense.
And he's been out. He's fresh. He's back. He's a senior. He wants to come and make a big impact in this game, and he is the horse behind this offense. He is the guy. This offense likes to run the ball, and he is the biggest key to it.
Keeper by Ellison on the read, and Ellison going to be tackled by Shaw at the 23-yard line, as that's a 7-yard pickup for Kevin Ellison, as we take a look at the impact players with Georgia Southern now on offense.
Matt Breida, he's that home run hitter. Miles Campbell is the guy. When they try to get the ball down the field, he's the one with the speed. And for Georgia State, Michael Shaw is making all the plays in that front seven, and Bobby Baker in this secondary. Only 5 passes, touchdowns have they given up all season.
Second down and 2, the call from the 24-yard line. Breida gets the handoff, and Breida up to the 28-yard line. Michael Shaw in on his second tackle. Shaw comes out of there saying that Breida fumbled the ball. No indication from the officials just yet. And it is Georgia State's ball. Matt Breida apparently fumbled at the bottom of that pile, and the Panthers take over at the 26.
Michael Shaw making me and you look good for impact players already. Matt going in, making plays. He is a great wheel linebacker. He can make tackles in and outside on a team. And right here, looking like Shavonye Lawrence might have stripped the ball as Matt Breida was going to the ground right there.
Wow, so the Panthers take over, having already taken a 7-0 lead. Shavonye Lawrence with the strip of Matt Breida, and the Panthers take over at the 26-yard line, first and 10. So an inauspicious start for the Georgia Southern Eagles as they're back on their heels defensively. Stubbs goes in motion to the top of the screen. Manning time goes across the middle and nearly intercepted at the 4-yard line by Joshua Moon.
Connor Manning just a little much, too much air under the ball right there, trying to get it to Robert Davis down the middle of the field. The middle of the field is wide open when Stubbs went in motion. Georgia Southern might want to make a linebacker or a safety more in the middle of the field just because Connor Manning does have the ability to scramble and go get some yards.
Joshua Moon, another one of the Atlanta area kids. He played at Creekside High School in Fairburn, Georgia, just south of the city. Nobles goes in motion behind the line for the Panthers. Handoff goes to Glenn Smith. Not going anywhere. He got stuck hard at the 28-yard line. That was Logan Hunt, I believe, on the tackle for the Eagles. Dropped him for a loss.
Logan Hunt, Darrell Sapp. They're very impressive physically inside with this defense of Georgia Southern. A lot of size up front. They're going to have to keep the ball out on the edges if they want to have success running the ball.
Man, their defensive tackles are as beefy as anybody in college football. Third down and 11 now for the Panthers. Manning stands in the pocket. Got a man. Ari Wirtz, touchdown. On third and 11, a 27-yard touchdown pass to Ari Wirtz, the sophomore, and the Panthers have taken a 13-0 lead.
There's nothing about this throwing catch that you couldn't put in a video and show kids how to run it. Nice touch here by Connie Manning. Great protection up front. And the tall, lanky tight end going up to reach and grab it.
The ruling on the field was of a touchdown. The previous play is under further review.
They're going to see if Wirtz got into the end zone with the football before the knee touched the ground. Wirtz. So the key will be, where is the ball when the knee hits the ground?
Good protection up front for Connor Manning. Nice touch and delivery.
Down.
Ball down. Elbow.
I think he's in. I mean, the knee is down, but where the ball is when the knee hits is the key, and I believe he was extended over the goal line when his knee hit the ground. Now watch. Knee hits the ground. Where's the ball when the knee hits the ground? Knee is down right there, and I think he's broken the plane of the goal with the ball when his knee hit the ground.
I agree with you. I think the plane had been broken.
This is a better look at it right here, I think. And again, knee hits the ground. Where is the ball in the midst of this transaction?
What a quick catch by. That's more of a receiver type catch right there. For a tight end, making that body adjustment is what a nice catch there by Wirtz.
Well, the play under review, I believe they're going to rule this a touchdown for Ari Wirtz. Connor Manning coming off his best game as a Georgia State Panther last week in the loss against UL Monroe, threw for 422 yards.
And in this game, you can see that the offense has come out and just have decided, you know, for at least a day, we're going to throw the ball around, we're going to get the ball downfield, and we're going to let our best athletes, which is in the skill position receiver core, go out and make plays for us.
And let's face it, the secondary has been a big issue for Georgia Southern this season. Inexperienced.
After review, the runner's elbow is down with the ball at the half-yard line.
Wow, okay.
It'll be first and goal from the half-yard line for Georgia State.
So the Panthers will have it first and goal to go.
Got no credit for the creativity of the catch for Warts. What a big-time catch, though. Nice protection up front. This offense through the first 5 minutes of this game is really on fire.
So Tim Lapano, the interim head coach, his team facing a first and goal to go after they had forced the fumble of Matt Breida trying to cash in with the short field and take a 2-touchdown lead.
Here's where having Kyler Neal in these situations is good to have back. He is more of the power back. Even though he's smaller, he has more of that fullback mentality when he runs the ball.
Instead, Manning's going to take it in for the touchdown. So Connor Manning takes it in from half a yard out, and now it really is 13-0.
Just mano a mano up front, quarterback draw on the half-yard line. Easy right there for Georgia State just to push the ball over.
So an impressive start for the Panthers. They've taken a 14-0 lead while the Eagles have run only two plays on offense. Tim Lohaus on for the PAT. Daniel Ziegler is back in there snapping for the Panthers today. I believe he is. And the kick is no good. Trying to see if that was Ziegler snapping the ball. Was 74 out there snapping. Panthers missed the PAT. Georgia State with a 13-0 lead on Georgia Southern less than 5 minutes into the game. Number 92, Jonathan Battle, got a piece of that PAT for Georgia Southern on their kick block unit and prevented that extra point by the Panthers. You'll see 92 come through here and jump up at the last moment, just jumped right through the line and got a piece of it.
You got Hunt at about 300 pounds pushing Battle. That's about 330. That's a lot of weight trying to get through one hole.
Miles Campbell's going to take it right there by the pylon. And Campbell weaves his way up to the 27-yard line, and then a flag is out after the tackle by Javonte Lane. So we'll check the penalty call here. Jason MacArthur is our referee today. So a big play by Jonathan Battle. We'll see if that blocked PAT comes back to help the Georgia Southern Eagles at some point today.
A lot of energy by this Georgia Panther team so far in this game.
There are two fouls on the play, both against the receiving team. Illegal block in the back, number 43 receivers. That penalty's declined. Holding number 12 on the receiving team. That penalty's accepted. 10 yards from the spot of the foul. First down.
Holding call against starting wide receiver B.J. Johnson. So instead of the 26-yard line, that's going to bring it all the way back to the 10. There was the block in the back that was declined on Chaz Thornton. I didn't see the hold. But B.J. Johnson was the one flagged for the penalty. So the Eagles, who've run only two offensive plays thus far and are down two touchdowns now, start at the 10-yard line. Campbell in motion behind the line. They'll throw the ball to B.J. Johnson. Johnson's going to reverse his field and try to go back the other way. And Johnson gets tagged by Alonzo McGee at the 13-yard line.
And this defense of Georgia State, a lot of us look at the record at 2-8. Other than last week against Monroe,
yep.
They have been stellar all year, and they started off already. They're one of those defenses, they can play from sideline to sideline. They have a lot of speed and a lot of aggressive players over there.
Well, prior to the UL Monroe game last week, Wayne, they had allowed only three offensive touchdowns total in their previous three games combined, but then they got pushed around by the Warhawks last week. Handoff Matt Breida, and Breida's going to bull his way up to the 19-yard line. McKendie Cherador, who's been out with an ankle injury the last couple of weeks, making that tackle for the Panthers.
One thing you have to like if you're a Panther fan is this is how you beat a team like Georgia Southern, who loves to run the ball, not really want to pass the ball. You come out early and get up on them, make them uncomfortable, have to do things that they really, really are not built to do, which is throwing the ball.
Well, Coach Summers was really excited to see his offensive unit finally be able to maybe click the way they had intended for it to click the entire season without worrying about a kid's ankle, hip, or knee. Third down and one now. Handoff, Breida, not going to get there. He gets stonewalled at the 18-yard line again. McKendy Cherador coming up with the big tackle.
McKendy Cherador is that big piece that was missing last week against Monroe. He is back, and he's already making his effect in this game. The best thing that you like about plays like that is the bodies that you see in Georgia State. It's 7-8 people at the ball when the tackle is going on.
Cedric Stone standing deep for the Panthers. Tyson Summers' team having to kick with Matt Flynn standing at the 5-yard line to take this punt. Flynn booms it away. Stone has to go all the way back to the 29-yard line, calling for a fair catch. So a great flip-the-field punt by Matt Flynn, and the Panthers will go on offense at close to their 30-yard line when we get back. Georgia State off to a good start here today, leading Georgia Southern 13-0. 7 minutes into the ballgame at the Georgia Dome, Georgia State leading Georgia Southern 13-0. Matt Stewart along with Wayne Gandy. And Wayne, interim coach Tim Lapano said it's really been tough on the young coaches and the young players in particular this week with the firing of Trent Miles. But he told the players, guys, this is your first job interview here today on the field Saturday.
Yeah, a lot of people go into games like this and think, oh, well, you're 2-8 and you don't have a lot to play for. You do have a lot to play for.
Offside, defense, number 57, made contact, 5-yard penalty, still first down.
If you're a senior thinking maybe there's a next career at the next level, you have that to play for. If you're a backup, you have positioning for spring ball, and then you just have the competitive nature of a player. It's game time. It's time to go up, go out, and play.
First and five following the penalty on Zach Copeland. Fake a handoff to Kyler Neal. Panthers going for the home run. It's caught by Robert Davis over on the far side, and then he wipes out the official. All the way down to the 29-yard line. That's 48 consecutive games now that Robert Davis has caught a pass, and that leads the nation.
It all starts with the protection up front, the run fake. Then Connor Neal just airing it out to Mr. Reliable right there. A jersey that could easily be hanging up, being retired here at Georgia State. Robert Davis, the all-time leading in receptions and yards at the receiver position.
210th catch of Robert Davis's career. First and 10 for the Panthers at the Eagles 29. Kyler Neal gets the handoff, trying to get to the outside. Bulls his way for a couple of yards out there on the edge. Ironhead Gallon making the tackle for the Eagles.
Ironhead Gallon, a little undersized in the middle there at 5'10", only about 210 pounds. Really more like a safety playing linebacker, but he will come up and hit you just like he is a linebacker. Great player. Leading tackler for this team.
Yeah, lives up to the building of his nickname. Smith in motion to the top half of the field. Manning looking over that way, now going to the other side, wide open, Robert Davis. That's a touchdown! Robert Davis, a 28-yard touchdown catch from Connor Manning, and the Panthers pouring it on here in the first 7 minutes of the game. They lead it 19-0.
What a throw there, and what a double move by Robert Baker. Good protection once again up front, and he just threw a number four, Bryson, a double move on him, touchdown, and the strength of his hands to hold the ball while falling right there is just as impressive as the catch.
17th career touchdown catch for Robert Davis. That's number two all time on the Georgia State career receivings list, and Tyndall Lohaus on there for the PAT. 20-0 Panthers in the first 7 minutes and 5 seconds of this game.
Just watch this play right here and this throw and catch between Manning. It starts up front, no pressure, all the room, and then it's just a touch on the ball in the hands of Robert Baker. As you said, 210 times he's been able to bring the ball in. he is the best receiver they've had here in Panther and one of the best in the Sun Belt. He definitely, Matt, has a chance for the next level. The size that he has, 6'3", 200 pounds. He seems like he doesn't have the speed, but you always see him behind the defenders, which it's just Robert Davis. He has been an all-time great here.
I tell you what, he's one of the top lines on Coach Tim Lapano's resume. Lapano is the guy. Came here in 2014 after coaching Calvin Johnson, among others, with the Detroit Lions, and has really been credited with developing Robert Davis, a very raw wide receiver who basically was a perimeter-blocking wide receiver at Northside Warner Roberts High School. Caught only 9 passes entire senior year of high school. Turned him into the career active leader in the Sun Belt in receptions.
And sometimes that's all it takes. It takes a coach seeing what you can be in that possibility and passing it on to you. And Robert Davis, when he's on that football field, you see the confidence that he has as a receiver. Just when how he catches the ball, the class in which he does it, what a great play.
Miles Campbell will take it 2 yards deep in the end zone and bring it out. And Campbell going to have trouble getting the ball up to the 20-yard line. Antrell Allen making that tackle for the Panthers. And so the 21-yard line is where the Eagles go back on offense, and they're already down 3 scores. When we started this game at 2 o'clock Eastern, I asked you the question, what did you expect to see from the Panthers today? Did you expect to see this?
No. I expected to see more energy. I did not expect to see the explosiveness of this offense. But the one thing you do get when you get a new man running, all the old stuff goes out. All the tendencies, where we might go with the ball, who to lock on to, it goes out the window. And right now, these receivers and this quarterback are connecting at a high rate.
Good news for the Eagles is there's still a lot of football left to be played, so they don't have to get away from what is their game plan, and that's running the football. Ramsby on the carry, first carry of the day for L.A. Ramsby, and he batters his way out to the 29-yard line. Ramsby's been battling an ankle injury. You know, Tyson Summers told us that they went from having 5 unreal running backs and quarterbacks over the last month to having only Matt Breida healthy enough to play.
And when you look at this run game, twofold, it needs to get them down the field in the end zone, but it also needs to give their defense a break. Their defense has been out there basically this whole quarter. This offense has to get a couple of first downs to even get them a breather.
Second down and 3 from the 29-yard line. Ellison looks one way and the next. No place to go with it, and incomplete. Nobody in the vicinity of that pass other than Shandon Sullivan, the cornerback for the Panthers, and now it's third down.
The back end of this defense of Georgia State is possibly the best in the Sun Belt. Right there, no real pressure on the quarterback, but just nowhere to go with the ball because of Bobby Baker, Shandon Sullivan, Jerome Smith, and those guys on the back end.
Third down and 3. Ball at the 29-yard line. The Eagles desperately need to pick up a first down here just to stay on the field with their offense. Ellison going to keep it, and he's going to pick up that much-needed first down at the 34-yard line. So Ellison able to move the sticks. Caleb Ringer making the tackle for the Panthers. He started today at inside linebacker after Trey Payne was suspended by the Sun Belt Conference for the first half of this game for a hit that came in the second half of the last game.
A hit that wasn't called in the last
right.
game.
But seen
went
on
back
film.
And reviewed the film and decided that it was worthy of injection from the last game, which carry over to the new game, which is today. I'm quite sure he's anxious sitting on the sideline wanting to get into this game.
So first and 10 for the Eagles at the 35-yard line. Ellison going to keep it again. And Ellison gets stonewalled there. Just a 1-yard pickup. Again, Ringer in on that tackle for Georgia State.
Last week, Thomas Coffey and Monroe were able to really breach this defensive front. And right now, so far, they're showing you the Georgia State defense from the first 9 games right here. And sometimes that's what happens. You have an off day, and you go back, and that's what gets you back focused to what you need to do.
Second down and 9. Ball is at the 36-yard line. Run an option. First time they've run option here. Ellison's going to keep it, and he's going to sprint up to the 41-yard line. Ringer again on that tackle, as well as Alonzo McGee. And it's going to bring up third down and about 4 for the Eagles.
Alonzo McGee, he's one of those guys. He's all over the field. He's had a breakout season this year as well for this defense. And they're just a fast defense. They're not too big in the middle, but they have guys that can get off blocks and make plays.
Third down and four for Georgia Southern. Ellison throwing downfield, looking for Crockett. It's caught by Monte Crockett out of bounds, and a big first down downfield for the Eagles.
Once again, up front for Kevin Ellison, good protection by the offensive line, giving him time for the receiver to come across the field. A little short rollout here and airing the ball out, getting behind Bobby Baker right there to make a big catch, throwing catch for this offense. Now, they don't like to throw it a lot, but when they do, they need those type of effective throws to happen.
Yeah, Wayne, too bad that Crockett couldn't stay in bounds because he had easy sailing to the end zone. First and 10 for the Eagles at the Georgia 7-24 as the Eagles show some life here on offense. Ellison right up the middle. Kevin Ellison with the touchdown.
Just what this Georgia Southern offense has been missing, a healthy Kevin Ellison right here. Big pass play, the previous play, and right here, just a little read zone up the middle. At the times when he goes to run, you don't know that he's not the running back. That's the kind of running skills he has at that position, and that's why you see why they missed him even last week in that game.
A much-needed touchdown drive for the Eagles to get them back in this ball game as they cut it to 20-6, and Youngway Koo on for the PAT for Georgia Southern. He will put it through, and it's 20-7. So the Eagles finally get the ball rolling on offense, led by their veteran quarterback, Kevin Ellison. He took it the final 24 yards, untouched, and the Eagles cut the Panthers' lead to 13. Back at the Georgia Dome, 3.5 minutes to play here in the first quarter after kickoff through the end zone. Panthers run a one-yard run for Darius Stubbs, so second down and 9 coming up for Georgia State at their own 26-yard line. 20-7 the lead for the Georgia State Panthers, first game under interim head coach Tim Lapano. In fact, the players went to Charlie Cobb, the athletic director, when the news came out that Trent Miles was being dismissed, and asked Charlie Cobb if he would make Lapano the interim head coach. Heavy rush, Manning has to get rid of it, flags out, and Lapano was deeply moved by the fact that the senior and veteran players on this team had gone to bat for him with Charlie Cobb, the AD.
And that's where the players sometimes, a lot of people never realize that players know which coaches are truly invested into trying to help them be successful. And as we talked about earlier, even with someone like a Robert Davis, to see how big of strides he's made under Coach Lapano being his receiver coach probably was an easy pick for the players.
Face mask, number 77 on the offense. Half the distance to the goal from the previous spot, still second down.
So the offensive lineman, Tyler Simonson, is called for the face mask here. Yeah, you see he's got the face mask. Got his hands wrapped around Nardo Govan's face mask, and so that's a half the distance to the goal penalty against Georgia State. Puts him back at the 13-yard line and makes it second down and 22. Lynn Smith will set in the backfield. They'll fake a handoff to him, throw quickly out there to the 18-yard line to Ari Wirtz. Ukemi Eligwe making the tackle for the Georgia Southern Eagles.
And you can continue to see that they're going to use the short passing game, just running 2 yards off the ball. They're throwing the ball to receivers as an extension of their running game. They can't really get a running game going. Kyler Neal is back, but most of their good running backs are injured, out for the year, and they're going to have to use that short pass to try to create some short yardage situations for the offense.
Third down and 16. The aforementioned Kyler Neal is in there at running back behind Manning, and he'll get the handoff. And Kyler Neal going to get dropped at the 23-yard line. Jay Baldry coming up to make the stop for the Eagles, and now it's going to be fourth down, and the Panthers going to have to punt for the first time today.
First time we've seen all day that this Georgia Southern defense has stopped Georgia State, which has to be something big for them going into this next quarter, that they're going to help this team out. They're going to have to go out, make this Georgia State team take away the passes and make some plays.
Monte Crockett is deep for Georgia Southern as Brandon Wright line drive kick that Wright or Crockett can return from the 38-yard line, and he's got room. Monte Crockett across the 50, across the 40, the cutback. Here comes Crockett inside the 30 and finally dragged down at the 27-yard line by Shandon Sullivan. A great return by Monte Crockett, and it's amazing, Wayne, how success on offense breed success on defense and then special teams.
It's a snowball effect. Everybody is paying notice now. Kevin Ellison running that touchdown, and now the special teams giving them the short field. They're engaged. The momentum, as they say, has quickly shifted back to Georgia Southern.
Momentum is what you did on the last play.
Right.
So first and 10 for the Eagles as they have it at the Panthers' 27-yard line. And Tyson Summers' team back in business here in the first quarter after falling behind 20-0. There's the center, Andy Kwan, senior on this team. They'll have their senior day in 2 weeks when they close out their regular season against Troy there at Paulson Stadium. First and 10 from the 27. Breida gets the handoff. Nope. Ellison's going to keep it and come to the near side. And Ellison's going to step out of bounds at the 19.5 after picking up 7.5. Man, it's amazing how this offense, once they finally get Ellison out there, you know, get the kinks out, they start moving again, and they look like the offense of old.
Ellison is, as we know, he's basically a running back. He's a running back that can throw the ball. He runs the ball that way. He's a threat. You have to stay pat. If you're a linebacker, you can't overrun. And when you have that kind of skill level as Ellison does, he hurts you every time he pulls the ball and runs.
Second down and a short three from just inside the 20. That's Campbell in motion. Ellison going to keep it again. Sprint to the outside. Pick up a first down inside the 15, inside the 10, and down to the 5-yard line. And Kevin Ellison is on a roll.
Right here, just flat out speed. Patience to let the blocks happen, to see if he can get up the middle. Nothing's there. Now he's just running. It's just flat out speed by a quarterback. And if you didn't know, you would think that was a running back that just cut the ball back right there by Kevin Ellison.
Let me get to the outside and I will outrun you. That's the motto for Kevin Ellison. And he can do that to so many teams. First and goal to go for the Eagles at the 4-yard line. Ellison hops back, tries to get to the outside, and still picks up a yard on the play. He should have taken a 2-yard loss. Bobby Baker comes up to make the tackle for the Panthers, but he got a yard on that play.
That's
when he should have lost
quarter.
Two, but he might be hurt too. That's the end of the quarter. He's slow to get up. Maybe he's just
he's
resting.
Pointing down at his ankle right there to the trainer.
Wow, what bad luck that would be for Georgia Southern, and they've had so much injury bad luck this year. Just as Kevin Ellison had come back and was starting to get rolling, he might be hurt again. One quarter in the book, Georgia State on top, 20-7. Kevin Ellison on the bench with an injured ankle as we start the second quarter. It's second down and go to goal for the Eagles at the 3-yard line, and Fabian Upshaw, number 13, the other fifth-year senior quarterback on this team, has checked into the ballgame.
And Ellison might just be winded over there, Matt. He could just be winded, just missing a game last week.
Handoff Breida, and he's into the end zone for the touchdown. On the first play of the second quarter, the Eagles have cut the Panthers' lead to 20-13.
Finally, Georgia Southern is looking like the team that has bold possibilities still left in their season. Here, Fabian Upshaw just handing the ball off. Offensive line getting big push right there against Georgia State, who showed last week at times they are kind of undersized in the middle. Big play, big run by Matt Breida.
Youngway Koo on for the PAT as the Eagles try to cut the Panthers' lead to 6. It was a 4-play 27-yard drive after that big punt return by Monte Crockett set up the short field. And Youngway Koo puts it through, and the Eagles, after falling behind 20-0, Wayne, have made it a 20-14 game.
It seems like night and day in one quarter. One team was hot and really having their way, and now Georgia Southern with a couple of breaks here and there, a big pass play by Kevin Ellison earlier, and then the big run for the touchdown right up the middle seemed to put all the other parts of this team of Georgia Southern on fire. The defense now is showing up, special team making an impact. Hopefully Kevin Ellison is just winded, maybe a cramp, and can get back in this game.
So you see the four-play 27-yard drive after the 34-yard punt return by Monte Crockett set it up, and that came after a big stop by their defense, and it seems like as the offense has finally found their juice, so has the Eagles' defense and now their special teams.
And this team is built around this offense. It's one of those, we're going to run, we're going to and run, and we're going to run, and we're going to run, and the defense feeds off of that, and that's why they call it a team, because each part sometimes has to carry the team for a while.
Tyler Bass will kick off for the Eagles from the 35-yard line. Trey Barnett and Darius Stubbs are deep for the Panthers. Barnett will watch it go through the back of the end zone, and so the Panthers start at the 25-yard line. So now Georgia State, that was moving the ball very well until their last possession, now they're back in a tight ball game again. We'll see how they respond, Wayne.
So far, a lot of poise for this offense. I expect them to come back out, continue to still work the field as they have, downfield, trying to make big plays against the secondary that has had its problems all season long.
Yeah, the Panthers have had no problems throwing the ball against Georgia Southern so far today. 172 yards of total offense and 132 in the air in the first quarter.
Yeah, picking up from last week where Connor Manning threw over 400 yards, three touchdowns. That part of the game they know they can do. They just have to continue to do it.
Manning bobbles the snap. They throw it back here. I don't know what happened on that play as Jawan Noble circled back around and got dropped for a loss back at the 19-yard line by Trey Griffin.
Offside, defense, number 90. 5-yard penalty, still first down.
Darius Sapp offside, so that negates the loss by the Panthers, makes it first and five. It's a big old boy right there.
Mr. Sapp. Yeah, when you make a 9 and a 0 look small, you have to call him Mr.
That's right.
Sapp right there.
So first and five for the Panthers from the 30-yard line. That's Wirtz in motion. Play action, and there it is. Keith Rucker across the 50. Rucker across the 40. Down the sideline, Priest. Keith Rucker, and finally steps out of bounds at the 26-yard line. William Bussey finally shoves him out of bounds.
And this Panther team has had a lot of success with the tight end. Last year, Joel Ruiz and Keith Rucker, and this year with Wirtz and Rucker. Been kind of injured there, but big play once again. Started the game with a big down-the-field throw with Connor Manning and Keith Rucker.
So the Panthers' offense picks up right where it left off in the first quarter. 44-yard pass play to Keith Rucker, and it's first and 10 from the 26. Toss goes to Glenn Smith. And Smith going to get stonewalled at the 23-yard line by Gallen and Logan Hunt.
When you look at this Georgia Southern defense, just pure size alone, you know you're not going to be able to run the ball up the middle. But the two things Georgia State has found is they can get some yardage on the ground, on the edges, and working the middle of the field downfield has paid big dividends so far.
Second down and 7 for the Panthers at the Eagles 23. Already 34 points total scored in this game in the first 16 minutes. Empty set, Manning throws through behind Jawan Nobles, who had a breakout game, first four catches of his career last week in that loss against UL Monroe. And now it's going to be third down.
Just threw the ball behind him right there. Nobles came free on his break. Connor Manning just off on the timing, threw the ball behind him.
Panthers are 1-for-3 on their third downs today. This is a third down and 7. but the one that they did convert on a third and 11 was the long pass all the way down to the one-yard line to Ari Wirtz. And now
Georgia
a timeout
Southern.
Has been called by Georgia
That's their
Southern.
First timeout of the half. This will be a 30-second timeout.
So we'll take a timeout as well as the Eagles stop to think about this third down play coming up.
Correction. It's a media timeout.
1 minute and 44 seconds into the second quarter in a back-and-forth game. Matt Stewart along with Wayne Gandy. Now Georgia Southern's backs against the wall defensively. Got the Panthers in a third and seven situation coming out of this timeout.
They seem to be making a coin toss on who has the energy and when do they have it. Right now, Georgia State in a big play right here because their special teams has been kind of shaky late. So I don't know if they want to line up and have to do a field goal.
No, that's one of the big reasons I think that Trent Miles was relieved of his duties before the end of the season. Just the horrendous showing by the special teams the last 3 weeks. Manning with time stands in the pocket. His man goes down. Was looking for Glenn Smith at the 6 yard line. And Kimmy Aligwe, the linebacker, was on the coverage. And now it's going to be fourth down, and we find out, do they try a field goal here? Do they go for it? Looks like a field goal.
And having success in this may keep them trying field goals at this distance, or it might send Coach Lupano into the mindset of, you know, unless we're inside the 15, we're going to be going for it for the rest of the game.
Well, they've lined up to go for a 40-yard kick from the right hash. Rohir Tinlohaus, the senior.
It all starts with protection up front. Those two guards and two tackles.
And the kick is blocked. It's going to be picked up by the Eagles inside the 5 yard line. Monquavius Brinson picks up that loose ball, and once again the Panthers have trouble in their special teams. They've had a PAT block and now a field goal block today.
The old adage of you never want to put something on film, especially in the special teams, right up the middle once again.
I think it was the same guy who blocked the PAT, Jonathan Battle.
And you got three players that are over 300 pounds, and they're all pounding that same hole. About 1,000 pounds of weight is coming on that guard and tackle right there, and just getting your hands up. Low kick right there by Lohaus, blocked again.
Yeah, I think it was Jonathan Battle who got the PAT, also got the field goal there. I'd have to see the replay again to make sure. But a first and 10 now from the Eagles at the 15-yard line. Fabian Upshaw stays in the ball game, and he picks up 6 yards up to the 21. Remember, Kevin Ellison got hurt on the final play of the first quarter, injured his ankle again.
Fabian Upshaw been out 7 games this season. He's happy to be back, and I'm quite sure Georgia Southern, regardless of Ellison being in and out, Upshaw is a talented player and definitely a guy that used to come in and just spell Ellison anyway to make some plays.
Yeah, here's the deal. They're just as good running that offense with Upshaw as they are Ellison. It's just a matter of who has the hot hand. Second down and 4. Breida gets the handoff, and Breida not going anywhere. Cherador leading the way for the Panthers on the tackle. Breida maybe got 1 yard on the play up to the 22.5. Brings up third down and short.
And Upshaw and Ellison may get a lot of the storyline here today, but Matt Breida, you have to keep your eye on him. He's one of those guys. He's led the country in yards per rush. This team does rush over 220 yards a game. Leading the Sun Belt, so you have to keep your eye on Matt Breida all day long.
Third down and 2. What would you run here, Wayne?
I would put it in Breida's hand. Let's make a play.
Instead, Upshaw going to throw it. Instead, he's going to run it. Not sure what he's going to do. He's going to take a loss back at the 17-yard line. Jerome Smith, the cornerback, with the sack, and the Eagles are going to have to punt.
Upshaw setting up for a quick throw, just nothing there, no one to go to. And the pressure of Georgia State, who, as we have said all game and all year long, has been a very stout defense to try to do anything against, not just run, but throw the ball especially.
Yeah, I think one of the big keys with the Panthers defensively this year is their ability to get a pass rush from their front four and not have to blitz as much as they did in years past. It's led to more interceptions. They've been able to play more zone coverage. High kick Stone making catch at 39.5-yard line. And that's where the Panthers will go back on offense when we get back. 10:47 to play in the half. Georgia State on top, 20-14. Tyson Summers' team trying to get bowl eligible here at the end of the season. They've lost six of their last seven since they started the season 3-0. They'll need to win today and then win their regular season finale against Troy two Saturdays from now at Paulson Stadium to be bowl eligible. Panthers go back on offense at the 40-yard line. Kyler Neal gets the handoff, and Neal picks up 4 yards on the play. Logan Hunt making the tackle for the Eagles. Panthers at 2-8, disappointing season after their first bowl appearance a year ago. Head coach Trent Miles fired on Sunday after the 37-23 loss to UL Monroe. And Tim Lapano, the wide receiver coach and a longtime college football assistant and NFL assistant, elevated to interim coach for the final two games. Second down and 4, play action. Manning in trouble, has to throw it away. Pressure coming from Trey Griffin, the defensive end.
Matt, you can say that both teams have had key injuries that's kind of derailed.
There's no foul for intentional grounding because the quarterback was out of the tackle box.
Key injuries, especially on the Georgia State side, but also the Georgia Southern. You have Kevin Ellison and Fabian Upshaw out, which offensively really put them in a bad situation. And with Georgia State, we know in and out of the lineup is Connor Manning, Penny Hart losing it early. You see the running backs, 3 or 4, Dorn, those guys being hurt really hurt them as well.
Todd Boyd, also one of their top wide receivers, lost for the season just a couple of weeks ago. Manning back to pass, fires, and it is broken up, incomplete. Glenn Smith, the intended target. Joshua Moon on the coverage there, the safety for the Eagles, and it's going to be fourth down for the Panthers as Georgia State has to give the ball up again.
Glenn Smith coming wide open, nice pass. Here's your safety. That's how you go attack the ball. Don't concede the pass. A lot of safeties now with all the rules concede and just come up to make a tackle. Right there, you can see coming to get the ball out.
Brandon Wright will kick from the 33. And the fair catch is made at the 20-yard line. And that's where the Eagles will put the ball in play again.
Matt, I must tell you that Moon has a great name to be a safety. Joshua Moon. That is a great name to be a safety.
I saw him play in high school at Creekside High School. He was a linebacker in high school. And, of course, they've moved him to safety. So he's done a great job here in his second season with the Georgia Southern Eagles. But special teams has once again been a big story here today, Wayne. Bad for Georgia State, good for Georgia Southern.
Both times, just right up the middle. The two defensive tackles just pushing the hole. Low kicks on both of the field goal tries. Well, the extra point and the field goal. And then right here, this is just a lot of talent, a lot of speed. Right here, giving a short field to your offense.
Yeah, that was the 34-yard punt return by Monte Crockett that set up the Eagles' second touchdown of the day. Second down and 7 coming up after the 3-yard gain. Georgia Southern with 126 yards of total offense so far in this game. 91 on the ground and 38 through the air.
Good to see Kevin Ellison back in the game for the Eagles.
Second down and 7. Zone read. Ellison going to sprint to the far side and pick up the first down or close to it as he's shoved out of bounds by Jerome Smith. And you see Tyson Summers having to play cop over there and keep Ellison and Jerome Smith from any extracurriculars.
Calling a game earlier this year for Georgia Southern, Coach Summers talked about how he's had to go and get high school running backs to make his quarterbacks, like the Kelvin Ellisons, and just teach them because this offense is run heavy and the quarterback is counted on to run the ball. Right there, you can see even Kevin Ellison not conceding, going out of bounds, trying to get that extra yard.
First and 10, ball is at the 31-yard line. Ramsby gets the carry, and Ramsby picks up a couple of yards. Julian Laurent was the first guy to hit him low, and he fell forward for a couple. Brings up a second down and eight. Ramsby is another one of those guys. He was a high school quarterback at Coleraine High School in Cincinnati. Ran for 1,500 yards, 18 touchdowns, threw for 1,600 yards and 15 touchdowns his senior season.
A few offenses run, a few colleges run this offense where the quarterback is old school, almost triple option. They really are running the read option, a quarterback getting about half the carries.
Second down and seven. Ball is at the 34. Eagles down six here in the second quarter. Ellison stands in the pocket, now runs out of the pocket. And he's going to worm his way up to the 37-yard line and be about 4 yards short of the first down as Alonzo McGee makes the tackle for the Panthers.
This Georgia State defense is just going to have to continue to corral Kevin Ellison. You can see his natural instinct to run the ball. He can throw fakes. He has speed. He's just going to all have to run and corral him around and get him on the ground.
The Eagles are 2 of 4 on their third down so far today. Third down and four right here for Georgia Southern at their own 37. Ellison, heavy rush. They set up the screen. Ramsby going to take a big loss back at the 29-yard line. Alonzo McGee saw it coming, wasn't fooled. And the ball is going to have to be punted by the Eagles.
Watching this play, just not a good fake. The pressure comes, but no one's fooled right there. Alonzo McGee just sitting there in the flat, coming up to make the play. If he didn't make the play, Jerome Smith was also sitting there. No one fooled right there on that screen.
So Matt Flynn on the punt for the Eagles, standing at his 16-yard line. Cedric Stone deep for the Panthers at the 30. And Flynn, spiraling kick. It's going to hit at the 43 and bounce backwards in favor of the Panthers. Let's see where they spot it out. Looks like the 42 is where they're going to mark it. And that's where the Panthers are going to go on offense with 6:26 to play in the quarter. Tyson Summers said, you know, when he took the job in December, replacing Willie Fritz last December, the hot topic of conversation in Statesboro was the Georgia State game. It was still fresh on everybody's minds after the Panthers had drilled them 34-7 in the regular season finale.
And you can tell by just the crowd participation that this has slowly become only the third time, but to get this kind of turnout, two teams, 200 miles apart, three-hour drive, they bring out a lot of fans, and on the field they're both competing. And so this is an old-time rivalry.
Panthers going empty set again. They've done that a lot today. Manning going for the home run. Got a man out there and cannot connect with Glenn Smith. Glenn Smith.
91, Logan Hunt right there. Just getting enough pressure to make Connor Manning have to throw the ball a little too soon. If he could have held it one more click, Glenn Smith would have came open and possibly for a touchdown right there. But off the end, pick number 91 putting the pressure on.
Well, this is the third all-time meeting between these budding Sun Belt rivals. The Eagles clobbered the Panthers 69-31 when they played here in 2014, and the Panthers returned the favor, not by that big of a margin, but beat them 34-7 last year. Rucker with the catch up to the 50-yard line, and he gets close to 8 on the play. Keith Rucker with his fourth catch of the day.
Georgia State has really been working the middle of this field, whether it's Rutgers or Wirtz, or even earlier with Robert Davis catching something in the middle against this defense. A great game plan that they have to exploit what Georgia Southern does.
Rutgers started the day number 5 on the Panthers' all-time catch list, number 9 in all-time receiving yards, and number 4 in touchdown catches. It's third down and 2. Manning. That'll be a first down to Rucker as they go back to him for the 5th time today. Nicely executed there.
And when you watch this play, you wonder why they don't run more of this with Connor Manning. He is a good enough athlete that you can give him plays on the rolls and sprint outs, get him outside the pocket to deliver the ball right there. Good play action and play fake there by Keith Rucker.
Manning approaching 200 yards passing here in the first half. He's at 191 on 11 of 18. Handoff goes to Darius Stubbs, and Stubbs not going to get by DeShante Gallen. Ironhead Gallen making the tackle right there at the line of scrimmage.
Gallen coming from the linebacker position. And when he flashes into your TV, you really think it's a safety coming up.
Yeah, he's not big at all. And look at that helmet he has. It almost looks like a motorcycle helmet, doesn't it?
Great name for a linebacker, Ironhead. I played with an Ironhead, but he was on the offensive side of the ball.
Ironhead Hayward, the great Ironhead Hayward. Start at Pitt. Manning, they're going to set up a screen here for Glenn Smith. Got a crushing block right there, but a flag is out. So this one's coming back. Got a great block on the edge. But I believe a flag here on Michael Ivory was the guy who had the takedown. That's going to be a hold, I think.
Holding offense, number 75.
Yep.
10-yard penalty, still second down.
Michael Ivory, the fifth-year senior, he's a big one too, 6'5", 340. With the takedown out there in front of everybody.
And when you come outside and you run screens and draws and things like that as offensive linemen, you have to be very disciplined not to reach, because when you go out, you're on smaller defenders that's going to be throwing your fakes, and you're just trying to hit one of the people that you see in your face, and sometimes you get your hands in there. He knows it from when he got off the ground. You can see him clap his hands that he had held.
Second down and 20, ball back at the 47 now. Manning deep across the middle and just beyond the outstretched hands of Glenn Smith. Been trying to go to him a lot today.
Once again, not only trying to get the ball to Glenn Smith, but they're working that vertical line in the middle of this defense. It's something they see. They've had success early doing it right there. Just another second, if he could have held on to the ball, let Glenn Smith get completely behind the safety. But they are being aggressive still on offense, is Georgia State.
Third down and 20. Crossing route, Robert Davis doesn't see him. Now throws his direction, can't get it to him, as Davis was running out of real estate and Manning was running out of time. And the Eagles force the Panthers to punt.
Not bad protection there by the offensive line. Really a lot of deep verticals going on that play when you have that down in distance. Not enough time to be able to get that deep with the pressure that Georgia Southern is bringing.
Brandon Wright on the punt again for the Panthers. He's had a difficult season. His line drive kick earlier today allowed Monte Crockett to have a 34-yard return. Another line drive kick. Crockett, however, will not be able to return this one as it hits in front of him, and it was fielded at the 14-yard line. For some reason, Quan Howard grabbed it, and there's also a flag down at the 37-yard line. I don't know why Quan Howard tried to pick that ball up down there. Let's check the flag and the call here from Jason MacArthur.
Running into the kicker, number 27, the receiving team. The penalties declined. First down.
That's on Ironhead Gallen. The reason why the penalty is declined is because it would not have picked up a first down for the Panthers. So the Eagles back on offense at their 15-yard line when we get back. Matt Stewart and Wayne Gandy with you. Under 4 minutes to play here in the first half, and Georgia Southern back on offense at their own 15-yard line following the Panthers' punt. Handoff goes to Breida, and Breida going to be tackled at the 17-yard line by Julian Laurent. Now, the Eagles going with much more what they call 12 personnel today, tight end personnel. In fact, they've even got a converted defensive lineman, Ty Phillips, a freshman, number 96, playing on the offensive line today to help block.
Well, if you watch last week's game, you would think you're going to come in this game and try to do the same thing that Monroe did, which run the ball. So to be able to do that, you throw in an extra tight end because that's what you're dedicated to doing and get the run game going.
Fabian Upshaw going to try to sprint to the outside, and he's going to pick up the first down at the 27-yard line as Upshaw gets 9 on the play. So a first down for the Eagles as they move the sticks.
Holding offense, well, number 62, 10-yard penalty, still second down.
Erase that. Ryan Northrup, the left guard, is called for the hold. That'll take away the first down.
Seems that since Kevin Ellison went out earlier with an ankle issue, now it seems that Georgia Southern has settled into rotating him and Fabian Upshaw series to series.
Which is typically what they were doing earlier in the year. Now, number 96, Ty Phillips, is not out there right now, but they've been using him as an additional tight end or tackle today. But now they've got him off the field as they've gone to a passing formation. Second down and 15. Crockett in motion behind the line. Upshaw, lots of time for him. Now the time goes away. Fires complete to Crockett at the 15. And Crockett dragged out of bounds by Baker at the 21.
And a lot of times what you have on pass play, especially with running quarterbacks, is that the defenders, even if they're getting good rush, they try to stay in their lanes because they're afraid to cross his face, open up a running lane for the kind of talent that Ellison and Upshaw has. You don't want to get out of your pass rush lane too often.
Third down and 3. It looks like Tyson Summers wants them to be more up-tempo than they are right now, wants to get them going a little bit quicker on offense. Upshaw scrambling, throwing. That's a first down catch at the 29-yard line by the tight end, Ross Alexander.
Good hit-up play right there by Upshaw. He felt a little pressure there at first and almost trips himself down. I think me and you would have failed on that, Matt. You know,
definitely. Flat on my face. First and 10 at the 29-yard line. 2 minutes to play in the half. Breida gets the handoff, and Breida going to be stopped right there at the 30. Not much running room right there.
Not a lot of running backs have gotten a lot of yardage against this Georgia State team. Mike Breida, the thing with him is, you know, if he has that home run speed, you want to stop him before he gets going.
Second down and 8 following the tackle by Terry Thomas. Ball at the 31. Time clicking down here. Heavy rush. Upshaw gets it out of there and had to in a hurry. Hampton McConnell, former quarterback turned wide receiver, was the intended target, and now it's third down.
Georgia State doing a good job of mixing it up, mainly just rushing forward, but when they do bring that fifth or sixth rusher, they're really forcing these quarterbacks to do something and get rid of the ball.
92 seconds to play in the half. Eagles have 2 timeouts remaining, and the Panthers have 3. Ball at the 31. Third down and 8. Pressure on Upshaw, and he's going to go down. I think they rule him down. Andrew Everett with the quarterback sack back at the 20-yard line.
There's no foul for intentional grounding. The quarterback was out of the tackle box, and the ball went beyond the line of scrimmage. Fourth down.
So I don't think they're going to rule a sack, just an incompletion there. They say Upshaw got rid of the ball before his fanny hit the ground.
And this is how you have success against a running team. You put them in third and long, somewhere that they really don't want to be. They're not really efficient at throwing the ball. You get them in third and long, and then you put some pass rush on them. The quarterbacks are so used to running the ball, it freezes them a lot when they feel that pressure.
So the Panthers will get the ball back with 3 timeouts remaining. Stone calls fair catch, makes it, running out of bounds at the 31-yard line. So the Panthers will be 69 yards away from the end zone with 1:17 and 3 timeouts remaining as they go back on offense here late in the second quarter. Tim Lapano, interim head coach, he described himself as a player's coach, a high-energy coach, felt like he's always gotten the most out of his players. His background is as a wide receivers coach in the NFL and here at Georgia State, but he's also been an offensive coordinator in his career 4 different times at Washington. Trent Miles was on that staff with him there at Washington with the Huskies, at Oregon State, Purdue, and Washington State.
And when you're a wide receivers coach, you almost have to be a coach's type player because you have to deal with some personalities.
I knew where you were going. All right, yeah, they're egos, right?
Yeah, some egos.
Got to baby them a little bit. Got to love them up.
You have to convince them to be who they can be on the field.
first and 10 for the Panthers from the 31. Pass thrown on the crossing route to Glenn Smith. Breaks out of a tackle, and Glenn Smith has the first down at the 44-yard line. Darius Sapp made the tackle downfield. I know what you're saying. I know you offensive linemen. Y'all don't get any of that. Y'all just get yelled at and cussed at and spit at. Y'all don't get any of that loving, do you?
No, we get no love. And usually when the line coach is the head coach, he gives no love. But
so first and 10 for the Panthers at the 44. All kinds of time for Manning. Comes over here on the far side and unable to make the catch. Keith Rucker going out of bounds at 40.
With three
47 seconds.
With three timeouts. And I'm very surprised, especially with success on that first play, that they're not moving real fast. They took 7 seconds just to snap the ball after the whistle.
And also surprised they're maybe not working the middle of the field a little bit more because they do have the timeouts.
Yeah, they do have the timeouts. The defense, at least on first and second down, to try to get something down the middle.
Luke Heward, of course, is the offensive coordinator for the Georgia State Panthers, the brother of Brock Heward, who we see here on ESPN as well. Second down from the 44. Manning dancing. Going to take a sack back at the 30-yard line. Zach Copeland broke through and dropped him.
And this is what happens when you're trying to get deep routes.
Timeout, Georgia State. That's their first timeout of the half.
Some good initial protection
timeout
up front by the offensive line. Georgia State trying
game
to get something
operator,
deep. You have to hold on another 2-3 seconds if you're offensive lineman in those kind of situations.
Seconds.
Right there, pressure up the middle.
Zach Copeland, the redshirt sophomore out of Lowndes High School in Valdosta, beat Gabe Mobley, the redshirt sophomore out of Moultrie, Georgia, and Colquitt County. For you folks in the state of Georgia, you know those are two big Region 1 rivals down there in South Georgia. So you know Copeland and Mobley have been going up against each other since their high school days, and Copeland got the best of him right there.
I think he's probably going to remind him when this game is over. Like, well, nothing's changed there, Mobley. Nothing changed.
Well, Copeland's alma mater, the Lowndes Vikings, got a huge second-round playoff victory at Norcross last night, 57-21, and his alma mater has scored 148 points in their first two playoff games.
Is this video games? Or hats off to them. That kind of offense, and you said they're just running a whole lot of speed out there for them.
So here you go. It's going to be third down and 23 now from the 31-yard line. Kyler Neal trying to get to the outside and going to get knocked hard out of bounds by Ironhead Gallen. Gallen was there, and then help came up in the form of Christian Matthew.
Timeout.
To finish off
Georgia
the play.
Southern. It's their second timeout of the half. This will be a 30-second timeout. The game clock operator, please put 34 seconds on the game clock.
So they're going to add two more ticks to the clock, and it's fourth down, and now the Eagles are going to get the ball back, and they have two timeouts remaining.
Right.
And given the problems that the Panthers have had in their special teams, I'm guessing the Eagles are going to send everybody here.
And I think that's perfectly why they called a timeout. Let's see if they can execute their special team. They've had punts blocked, they've had field goals blocked, and they've had returns given up. So it's not just the protection game. The coverage teams haven't done that well over the last couple of weeks either.
You know, and Tim Lapano told us this week that the first thing he did when Charlie Cobb said, look, I want to make you the interim coach, he said, look, we're going to clean up the special teams. And he said they worked really hard on that this week. Number one, changed some of the personnel. Number two, kind of retaught some of the fundamentals and the techniques and put the guys in some tough situations in practice to try to turn the heat up on them a little bit.
And I think it's the function of
Wright gets it away. Crockett chance to return this from the 24. Remember, Crockett's already had one big punt return today. And here's another one across the 50. And down to the 40-yard line, Monte Crockett with another big return. Tackle made by Tevin Jones. And the Eagles got a great chance here to get at least three before the end of the half.
The one phase of college football that has suffered due to the shortage of times that athletes can be over at the facility and practice is the special teams. You're trying to get a lot of done in a small time in the special teams game, and it's starting to show its head on all levels of college football.
Wayne, back in the day when you were at Auburn, how many hours a week did y'all practice?
We practice, turn the lights on at least 4 hours a day.
Yeah, there you go.
They had no limit then.
I know they did. Until the coach was happy or tired, one or the other. First and 10 for the Eagles. Ball at the 41-yard line. Upshaw still in there at quarterback. Dancing, looking to throw it, fires it out of bounds. And I don't think it's my imagination. This Eagles offense has not been as smooth with Upshaw at quarterback as it was with Ellison at quarterback.
He's very indecisive of where he wants to go in the pass game. Run game, he's okay. But mind you, he has been out.
And they brought the freshman Seth Schumann into the ballgame. They said this was a possibility today when they got into a one-minute drill. This is a 14-second drill right here. The freshman Seth Schumann, who started against UL Lafayette, now in there at quarterback. He's the better passer of the three quarterbacks. Let's see what he can do. Schumann, who's out of Valdosta High School, scrambling. He's going to run it forward and still on his feet and dives forward to the 26-yard line with 5 seconds on the clock. Gives the chance for the Eagles to kick a field goal here.
Very, very, very interesting in this set that he didn't just come out at the first play to run the 2 minutes. To come off in second and long to try to start the 2 minute is very interesting.
Well, I can't help but feel the irony. You bring in Schumann because of his arm, and he runs it for the first down to get you in field goal range.
When you put a passer in, especially when this defense is set mentally to stop the run, they see Schumann, and just like me and you, they feel they're going to come in and try to throw. You start turning your back to Schumann as the passing games evolve, and then he's running down the middle of the field.
So a big 15-yard run by Seth Schumann to put the ball at the 26 with 5 seconds to play in the half. And Youngway Koo is going to try a 43.5-yard kick here to try to cut the Panthers' lead to 3 at the break. I mean, that's a tough situation. Hey, kid, get in there and go pick up a first down, get us in field goal range. And he did it. Good for him. From the right hash, Youngway Koo. Kick is on its way, and the kick is good. Youngway Koo with a big field goal as the half comes to a close, and the Eagles at one time down 20-0 go to the locker room down 20-17.
Georgia Southern, once they got the baton of energy, they started using it in their favor. Kevin Ellison sparked them. The defense started picking up. And then the special team started making plays, and now they're back in this game.
17 straight points for the Eagles, and they are back in the ball game as we have reached halftime at the Georgia Dome.
I'm proud of you, my man. Making simple, smart cashback choices. With Quicksilver from Capital One, you're earning unlimited 1.5% cashback on every purchase everywhere. Like on that new laptop. Quicksilver keeps things simple, Gary. And smart, like you. And I like that.
I guess I'm pretty smart.
Don't let that go to your head, Gary. What's in your...
You're watching the Capital One Halftime Report as we are at halftime here at the Georgia Dome. The Georgia State Panthers leading the Georgia Southern Eagles by a score of 20-17. Despite being in the midst of a 32-game losing streak, Division III Earlham College coach was voted Coach of the Year by his peers for his perseverance away from the field. His name is Nick Johnson. Gene Wojciechowski has the story.
I love everything about football. I love the game. I love being around the student athletes. I love the atmosphere.
Set him!
It's a really special thing to me on a deep spiritual and soulful level to be there and to do this job.
It's a great day to be alive!
This is Nick Johnson's second season as head coach of his alma mater, Earlham College in Richmond, Indiana. He is 0-17, and Earlham is winless in its last 30 games, the longest active losing streak in college football.
When you believe it, then you see it. You understand what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
When you believe it, then you see it. You may be one man, but your job, your obligation, is to believe today. EC Pride 03, 1, 2, 3.
EC Pride!
Let's go.
With only 37 players on their roster, nearly half of them freshmen,
good job!
The undersized Quakers lose to Manchester University 65-13.
I love being with you guys. I love doing this. I don't love losing, but I don't want to win with any other team. You understand what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
I want to win with you guys.
Nick Johnson's Saturday ended with a loss, but his Sunday began with a victory. He got to see his wife, Melissa, a patient at the University of Cincinnati Medical Center.
She's my best friend and the absolute love of my life.
He is the gentlest, most kind-hearted person that you could ever meet.
Look pretty today.
Thanks. He was everything that I had thought I would have in a husband and more.
Nick, the star defensive end, and Melissa, a team captain on the basketball team, first met at Earlham in 1999. They were married in 2005.
First 6-7 years of our marriage were awesome. He always tells me, you know, I married you for better, for worse, for sickness and in health.
Melissa's health took a turn for the worse several years after the birth of her second child, Jacob. She had a hysterectomy in 2014, followed by life-threatening issues with her pancreas in 2015. The same year, Nick was offered the Earlham head coaching job.
I said, what if I fail? What if I go down in history as the worst football coach Earlham has ever had? I don't want to do that. She said to me, what are you afraid of? What if you never do it? And I've carried that message with me every single day that she believed.
Just minutes before his first ever home game as head coach, Nick had to rush to a local hospital. Melissa had suffered a brain seizure and was going to be airlifted to Indianapolis.
It's an eerie thing watching a helicopter with your wife in it. You don't know if she lands, if she's gonna be alive.
He didn't care in what state he got me back. He just wanted me back.
I vividly remember my daughter asking me, is mommy gonna die? I said, we don't know. I said, daddy believes that she's not going to.
Melissa survived, but had to learn how to walk again. During the past 2.5 years, she has endured seizures, a coma, and more than 15 surgeries, including the removal of her pancreas, spleen, and parts of her stomach. She has spent almost 600 days in hospitals.
Melissa and her family have gone through a living hell. It's inspiring to us, first of all. We fight because we see them fighting.
You still have those dark moments that you're ready to say, I'm done. I throw in the towel. I know I've got two beautiful children that I fight for, but he really is my reason to wake up and breathe every day.
I still talk to her every day. I can still feel that love. I hear that strength. She's still there. And so I'm thankful for that.
For now, a family is separated from a wife and a mother. And a winless football team tries to make a coach proud.
He doesn't want us to feel sorry for him. Of course, you know, we will, because he is our coach and we do love him.
0-18 doesn't affect him because we know that we're winning at life. We're winning at saving my life. Couldn't think of a better role model for his players to look up to than him.
She doesn't care that I don't win. She doesn't care that I don't make a lot of money. She just cares that I love her and our kids. And yeah, we haven't won, but we're going to. I do believe that.
You get a game ball after a win. Who's gonna get that game ball?
You know what, I might give it to my wife. I might give it to my wife.
You're watching the Capital One Halftime Report in Atlanta. We are at halftime where the Georgia State Panthers are holding on to a 20-17 lead over the Georgia Southern Eagles. Panthers scored all 20 of their points in the first 8 minutes of the ball game, but the Eagles scored 10 in the second half and got a last-second field goal by Youngway Koo to cut it to 3. Halftime here in Atlanta. We'll come back and take a look at the first half highlights when we get back. Capital One halftime report continues from the Georgia Dome in Atlanta. This budding Sun Belt rivalry between the Georgia State Panthers, Georgia Southern Eagles, third all-time meeting. The series tied 1-1, and the Eagles still trying to become bowl eligible for the season, needing two more wins to do that. Matt Stewart joined by Wayne Gandy. And Wayne, Panthers started the game with a lot of energy under interim head coach Tim Lapano, but the Eagles finally got their footing. They've made it a close game. Who has the momentum right now?
Well, one team is winning the game on the ground. The other one is in the air. And the real difference in this game has been that Georgia Southern has capitalized on something that Georgia State has had problems with for the last couple of games, which is special teams.
All right, let's take a look at the first half highlights. And the Panthers came out smoking, scored on their opening drive, the 29-yard touchdown run by Glenn Smith to cap a 75-yard march.
The half running back, half receiver Glenn Smith right there, who's made big plays for this team all year long, setting up a touchdown right here. Connor Manning jumping in the end zone after a big pass to Aerie Works.
Yeah, but special teams problems right there where Jonathan Battle blocked the PAT, and who knows, that may come into play before the day is over. Touchdown pass across the middle to Robert Davis, and it was a 20-0 game. But Kevin Ellison went up the middle for 24 yards to make it 20-7.
Out last week, back this week, making big plays, and that touchdown seemed to spark this whole Georgia Southern team.
Yeah, on special teams as well, Monte Crockett with a 34-yard punt return right there. That set up the short 3-yard touchdown run by Matt Breida to make it 20-14.
And then once again, special teams, that same big hand of Jonathan steps in and makes that block, and then special teams has been just bad all around for Georgia State all last couple of weeks.
Yeah, and good for the Eagles. You saw the punt return by Crockett and then the 43-yard field goal by Youngway Koo at the end of the half to make it a 20-17 game. And you're right on the money. The rushing of the Eagles, they've got 126 out of their 176, and the passing of the Panthers, they've got 203 out of their 235 through the air.
And one thing that neither team is having a lot of success on third down. And I think that's going to be the key going into this second half. When I do get in third and short, third and long, that we convert and keep the drive going.
Well, so we've seen the Panthers' success through the air. We've seen the Eagles' success on the ground. Which one continues in the second half?
I think Georgia Southern will continue to be able to run the ball. Can Georgia State keep airing the ball out as they have last week and picking it up this week?
We'll see. It's 20-17 here at the break. We'll come back and get the third quarter started in just a moment.
All aboard the Tailgate 2000. Tuba Steve looking shiny. Next stop, college football playoff, man.
Larry, thanks for driving. I brought you some Dr. Pepper.
Joe Tess, man. It's like I'm the college football Noah. This is my arc. There's room for everyone.
Great, because I brought my good friend Jesse Palmer.
Why'd you do that?
Larry, my man. Hey, do me a favor. Why don't you fold these suits in the back, will you?
Suits in the back. Yeah. You got it. Hey, you just go in there and look more handsome for me, will you? I'll take care of these. Round trip!
Start of the second half, Connor Manning with 203 yards passing in the first half, and Georgia State holding on to a 20-17 lead on Georgia Southern. This is the first game for the Panthers since the dismissal of head coach Trent Miles on Sunday after their loss to UL Monroe last Saturday. He was the Sun Belt coach just a year ago as the Panthers finished the regular season on a 4-game winning streak and gained bowl eligibility for the first time in program history, but finishes up his 4-year career with the Panthers at 9-38. And Tim Lapano has been named the interim coach for the final two games of the season. The Panthers came out, successful start to this ball game, scoring 20 points in the first 8 minutes and now holding on. It remains to be seen who's got the momentum here headed into the second half.
Looking at this game, Matt, I think that both teams have decided that they want to play in this game and they want to compete. Even though Georgia State has nothing to do after the regular season, Georgia Southern does have an opportunity to win this game, play Troy, and move on to possibly a bowl. And I think that's how they got back in this game. They realized that taking advantage of the opportunity sparked by Kevin Ellison.
Eagles played in a bowl last year, first time in program history. Of course, they've won 6 FCS national championships in their program history. Beat Bowling Green in the GoDaddy Bowl. And the Panthers would love to keep the Eagles from bowl eligibility by beating them today. Return by Miles Campbell from the 5, and Campbell shot down at the 24-yard line. Antrell Allen in on that tackle for the Panthers. And so the Eagles go on offense, and Kevin Ellison is going back out there. This offense for the Eagles moved much more smoothly with Kevin Ellison at the helm. 2 of 5 passing for, 3 of 4 passing for 31 yards for Ellison. Upshaw was 2 of 5, but Ellison 10 carries, 78 yards, and a 24-yard touchdown run.
And after he left that seemed like an ankle injury, from that point on, he was in and out of the lineup. We don't know whether it might just be fatigue or he is hurt. But you're right, Matt. When he's in there, they seem to be much more engaged, much more efficient going down the field.
Well, he's going to run it on the first play of the game, and Ellison's going to get 9 yards right off the bat. Brian Williams, the safety, making the tackle way downfield after a 9-yard pickup by Kevin Ellison. I think the other question that, you know, fans watching football in the Sun Belt ask, what's happened to this running game? Matt Breida was averaging 8 yards per carry in his career, pretty much over 100 yards rushing per game in his career. He's got 7 carries for 18 yards today, and that's kind of been the way the season's gone. Ellison going to pick up the first down as he runs it to the 31-yard line.
I think they have so much success running the ball, especially with the quarterback. They're not getting enough in the pass game. When you look at them, they're first in the Sun Belt in run offense, but they're like 8th in total offense, which means that they're not getting enough out of the pass game to keep the offenses balanced, and they're starting to key on Matt Breida and the running backs.
First and 10, ball at the 41-yard line. Bobby Baker, the safety, creeping up on the edge on the right side. Now he backs out, and Campbell goes in motion. Zone read kept by Ellison. He's going to take a loss back at the 40-yard line. Shawanye Lawrence, one of the seniors playing their last games here at home for the Georgia State Panthers today.
And when I say you key on the running back, when you run a system like Georgia Southern does, you have to take a phase away. And so are we going to let the running back or are we going to let the quarterback beat us? Who are we feeling like if we shut down, we have a better chance? And right now, Kevin Ellison is having success, but no running back has been able to get any yardage so far in this game.
Second down and 10, ball at the 41. Breida gets the carry that time, and Breida tackled by Alonzo McGee at the 44-yard line, picked up 3 on the play.
The one thing you do have to take your hat off to with Georgia Southern is they do still continue to feed the running back. It's not one of those things where Ellison or Upshaw pulls the ball every time. They understand that it is a process, and in that process, the running back has to touch the ball, even if it's only garnering 2-3 yards.
McKendy Cherador, who was also in on that last tackle, looks like he may have hurt that ankle again. He was slow getting off the field, and the Panthers
Georgia State
swapped out a lot of personnel, and now they burn a timeout. So a big third down and 6 coming up for the Eagles. They'll be facing that big third down when we get back from this timeout. Third down and 6, ball at the 45-yard line for the Eagles. Ellison with time, lofts it up for Crockett. He can't catch up with it, and it's going to be fourth down.
Once again, Georgia State having enough success on first and second down to put them in third and long. And that is not where this Georgia Southern team likes to be offensively. Third and 2, third and 1, third and 3 is really what they like to be in, because then they can run their base offense, which is the read option.
So the Eagles now 3 of 8 on their third downs as Cedric Stone stands back at the 19-yard line for the Panthers to receive this punt from Matt Flynn. Flynn kicking from the 34. Wobbly kick. Stone makes the fair catch at the 17. And that's where the Panthers will go on offense for the first time here in the second half. So the Panthers with 235 yards of total offense in the first half, and 203 came through the air. And you mentioned it, no running game whatsoever for the Panthers. Glenn Smith has 31 yards rushing, 29 of them came on that one touchdown run. So you take away that one touchdown run, and the Panthers have 15 total yards from the running backs today.
Yeah, when you see them throw these long one-step drop passes, that's them really thinking run game for them. They don't really have a running back that's producing a lot.
Oh, my goodness, what a hit by Bowdry as he levels DeMarcus Kirk on the run.
What a hit right there for number 26, Jay Bowdry. Probably the most successful run by a running back today against Matt, other than Glenn Smith on that touchdown run. Gets smacked in the middle of the field.
A decleater by Jay Bowdry, the redshirt freshman out of Thomasville, Georgia High School. It was a four-yard pickup, so second down and six for the Panthers. Kirk goes in motion to the bottom of your screen. Manning fires. It's caught by Glenn Smith. He stumbles forward to the 32 for a first down. Yaligwe got a piece of him, but that's going to be a first down for the Panthers.
That's a hard cover for Yaligwe to cover Glenn Smith, the big middle linebacker right there. And Georgia State right there again, picking up where they left off in the first half, working the middle of the field with Glenn Smith, Keep Rucker, Ari Warrants. That middle of the field has been a weakness all day for Georgia Southern.
Fourth catch of the day for Glenn Smith, 27 yards. First and 10 from the 32. Play action. Going deep down the sideline. Nobles can't hold on to it. Jawan Nobles, the freshman, had it and then nearly had it intercepted as he bobbled it. Monquavius Brinson, the kid from Atlanta, nearly had the pick on the bobble.
Good protection, good play action fake. Good throw here by Connor Manning. All the work is done, just catch the ball, and a lot of times you'll be amazed, especially when you're a freshman. You start thinking about what you're going to do after you catch the ball, and Nobles right there just lost his concentration and dropped it.
Nobles, the freshman out of Smyrna, Georgia, here in the Atlanta area, Campbell High School, was a quarterback in high school. He'd never played wide receiver until he got here. Second down and 10. Trey Barnett goes to the far side, and Barnett going to be hit by Moon as he stumbles forward a couple more yards to the 36. And man down for the Eagles. Big old number 90, Darius Sapp, shaken up, and he'll hobble off the field.
A big piece of his, and not just size-wise, but his play in the middle is what really allows him to play so small at linebacker with Ironhead Gallon. You have that kind of weight. It's a la Ray Lewis in Baltimore. He was a smallest, more of a safety-type linebacker, but they had so many big bodies in front of him, it allowed him to be able to do that. And the same thing right here with Ironhead Gallon.
It's third down and six with the ball at the 36. Panthers 2 of 8 on their third downs today. Barnett goes in motion to the top of your screen. Manning fires. That's a first down catch by Glenn Smith. His fifth catch of the day. He gets it across the 50 to the 49.
Just too easy right here between Manning and Smith on this play. Cornerback playing off. Glenn Smith running the route. Nice, sharp in route right there to get the first down. Just too easy.
So first and 10, ball is at the 49-yard line for the Panthers. Barnett going to be tripped up in the backfield. Yaligwe got a piece of his ankles, and he was able to get a one-yard pickup on the play. Kimmy Yaligwe, transfer from Florida State, played his high school ball. He's another kid from the Atlanta area, Stone Mountain, Georgia High School. And that's one of the reasons why this is such a big rivalry. It's not just the fact that Georgia Southern and Georgia State are in the same state, but a lot of these kids played high school ball with each other and against each other.
Shows a lot of talent that's in the state of Georgia as well.
Pass wide open. Rucker makes the grab at the 32, and he's down to the 27. Keith Rucker with his team-leading sixth catch of the day.
It's almost a replay of the two previous catches he's had down the middle. This time having to wait on the ball. The first two times we're able to catch the ball and run after the catch. Keith Rucker and that middle of the field is open. The way that Georgia Southern is playing their defense today is allowing Georgia State to make a lot of yards.
First and 10 from the 27. Kyler Neal gets the handoff and a big hole for Kyler Neal, who pulls his way down to the 16-yard line. Joshua Moon got in front of him in a league way in on that tackle as well.
Big Michael Ivory, number 75, pulling and trapping the linebacker on the end of the line of scrimmage. You see him right here, the big body getting it moving. The kickout block on Gallon, and the hole opens wide for a big-time run by Kyler Neal.
Neal again on the carry. He had two rushing touchdowns in the 34-7 victory down in Statesboro last season. His whole season here has been plagued by a high ankle sprain, but this is his final home game. Actually, he's a fourth-year junior. He'll get one more season with the Panthers. Pardon me. First down, or make that second down and 8 from the 15-yard line. Jawan Noble's the target.
Just
Noble's running. Confused.
Yeah, both Connor Manning and Noble's look confused. Manning was expecting another route, which would have been a touchdown if Nobles would have ran it.
Third down and 8 from the 15. Eagles trying to stop him and keep him to just a field goal attempt here. Manning fires. Glenn Smith dives for the end zone. Touchdown. Glenn Smith with his second touchdown of the day. And the Panthers score for the first time since midway through the first quarter and take a 26-17 lead.
Deja vu, middle of the field open again. Connor just waiting on Glenn Smith, who's been covered by Ironhead Gallon. Georgia State has done a great job of getting him matched up on linebackers all day. You take that matchup anytime. Glenn Smith, part-time running back, full-time receiver, big play.
11 plays, 83 yards for the Panthers. Tim Lohaus with the PAT, and Georgia State has a 27-17 lead on Georgia Southern. Glenn Smith, the catch, 15-yard run for the score. Panthers back up by 10. Glenn Smith with 87 yards of offense today, a touchdown catch and a touchdown run on 9 total touches.
And on this play right here, Luke Hewitt, the offensive coordinator, all day long has been able to set the formation that there's a safety or a linebacker checking Glenn Smith, and it's killing this Georgia Southern defense right now.
Brandon Wright will kick off for the Panthers. Quan Howard a chance to return from the 7, and the play got blown dead.
A member of the receiving team gave an invalid fair catch signal. By rule, the ball is dead when it is caught.
Wow.
First down.
Wow.
A member of the...
So Quan Howard, the ball's going to be spotted at the 10-yard line. I didn't see anybody throw up their hands, did you?
I thought the receiver of the ball had to be the one to throw the fair. I didn't see anyone raise their hand either.
So he said a member of the receiving team, which indicates it wasn't Quan Howard, because if it was the receiver, you would have said that, right?
Correct. He would have.
My eyes were on Quan Howard. I didn't see anybody throw up their hands. And I'm like you. I always thought it was just the receiver that could do that.
And Howard turned around like, what's wrong with the play?
Wow. Well, Georgia Southern back on offense and now in a deep hole after that curious call by the official, Jason MacArthur. Keeper by Ellison. He's trying to get to the near side here, and Alonzo McGee going to drop him at the 14.5 yard line. And it looks like Ellison might be hurt again. Looks like he's reaching for his back.
His lower back.
And he might have gotten twisted up a little bit on that tackle by McGee. Man, I tell you what, it has just been that kind of a season for the Georgia Southern Eagles. You see, they're working on that lower back. It has been that kind of a season for Georgia Southern, just every kind of injury imaginable. Wesley Fields, who's one of their top running backs and a backup to Matt Breida, is out for today's game as well. Let's see if Ellison can get up here. Let's see if we can see what happened.
Right here, just trying to make something out of nothing, nowhere really to go. And just kind of twisted up right there. Can't really see where the injury occurred, but you're right. They seem to be checking his lower back.
Maybe a muscle spasm kind of thing if he got twisted up a little bit and his back kind of seized up on him, maybe.
He seems to be in a lot of pain.
Yeah. Well, if you've ever had your lower back seize up on you, you know, you can't move. And he's starting to move now. But this Georgia Southern offense has moved so much more effectively and efficiently with Kevin Ellison running the show instead of Fabian Upshaw, who himself is just now coming back from injury.
And Coach Summers has already shown us on that last couple of plays that he will put the freshman Schumann in. And if he gets down any further how this game is going, he might have to go to more of an air attack and try to win the game through the air.
Wow, this is the second time that Kevin Ellison has had to be helped off the field today. The first time at the end of the first quarter was an ankle. This does appear to be a back situation for him. You see Shawanye Lawrence and the Georgia State Panthers. Jerome Smith, great show of respect by the Panthers there to come up and give him the fist pump.
And he's a guy that they have faced the last three seasons, who's given them nightmares in here 2 years ago. And they will miss him for how his effect on this game. He is the piece that seemed to get everyone sparked and into the game.
That was a tremendous show of respect by the Panthers defense. At least four members of that Panthers defense came up there to give him a little fist pump, to encourage him here as he's walking off the field. And you're right. He has bedeviled, the Panthers' defense for a couple of seasons now.
And today, even in today's game, he has been the run offense for them, for Georgia Southern.
So second down now as Upshaw's back in there at quarterback at the 14-yard line. Blitz is coming. Upshaw going to run it and right up the middle to the 21-yard line. Tackle made by Charlie Patrick, the linebacker.
Fabian Upshaw is up to the task. He's been out for 7 weeks. So if anything is wrong with his game, it's his timing, the rust. But before those injuries and last season, he has been a part of when you put him in for Ellison, it's not really missing a lot. So he can come alive and make the same kind of plays.
98 of the Eagles' 150 yards on the ground have come from Ellison, and now he's on the sideline again, hurt again. Keeper Upshaw. Upshaw just a couple of yards on the play. Michael Shaw making the tackle for the Panthers. Michael Shaw, a kid out of Lanier High School here in the Atlanta area, Suwanee, Georgia. You know, he was a guy that was being recruited by SEC teams, but then, in his senior year, he didn't have his test score, and his GPA wasn't lined up in time. And so, all those SEC teams dropped off, and that opened the door for him to end up with Georgia State once he got his test score and he got his GPA right. Been a big pickup for them defensively.
Yeah, Georgia State is thanking them for cooling their heels and recruiting him and giving them a gem.
Second down and 8 from the 23. Upshaw the keeper, and Shawanye Lawrence going to grab him and pull him back at the 25-yard line as Upshaw got only 2 on that play. And it's going to bring up a 3rd down and 6, maybe more like 3 on the play as they'll spot it at the 26 and make it a 3rd down and 5.
And the advantage goes to Georgia State. Anytime they can create anything from 3rd and 5 plus, it gives them an advantage because Fabian Upshaw has been out, and he's more of a running quarterback than he's throwing.
Eagles are 3 of 8 on their 3rd downs today. Hand off Breida, and Breida moving the pile up to the 30-and-a-half, and he's close to the first down, depending upon the spot. Andrew Everett making the tackle for the Panthers. Let's see if they picked up the first down. They're not going to measure. It's going to be fourth down and less than a yard for the Eagles here at their own 30 and a half. You see Breida motioning to the sideline. He wants him to go for it. Would you go for it here?
No, I would punt the ball.
I would not go for it here either.
I would not give them the short field at this point in the game. It's a lot of time. It's the third quarter, and you're only down 10 points.
Yeah.
Big gamble here.
You still got a lot of game to play. Fourth and less than a yard, and the Eagles going for it in their own end. Keeper Upshaw, he picked up the first down. Great effort by Upshaw to pick up the first down, spin out of a tackle, and fall forward to the 33-yard line.
Might need to call Coach Summers for the lottery number tonight. Right here, just a desperation. Really nothing there. The hole wasn't there. He just fell forward for the first down.
And the Panthers had a shot at him behind the line of scrimmage and let him get away. So first and 10 now for the Eagles. So they roll the dice and win it that time. First and 10 from the 33. Upshaw fires. B.J. Johnson the catch, and he's up to the 42. Johnson had a 9-catch game in their loss against UL Lafayette two Thursdays ago. Of course, with the two quarterbacks out and Seth Schumann, the freshman, in there and falling behind, the Eagles had to uncharacteristically go to the air, and B.J. Johnson responded with a career game.
And dangerous pass there by Upshaw. Luckily, the defensive end didn't turn around, or that could have been a picked off for interception.
Second down and one from the 42. Miles Campbell in motion. Handoff. L.A. Ramsby up to the 50-yard line, and he picks up the first down, carrying Shandon Sullivan with him.
I think that Georgia Southern definitely has to take this approach from the rest of the game, that it's just going to be 3, 4, 6 yards. Sometimes as explosive as athletes as they have, you expect the big chunks of yards. But in this game, just like last week against Monroe, Monroe settled in for those 4 or 5 yarders. Georgia Southern can make a lot of money.
My goodness, the ball is loose, and it's picked up by Alonzo McGee. Campbell and Breida collided in the backfield. A SportsCenter not top 10 play right there, and the ball ends up in McGee's hands. Ramsby, it wasn't Breida, it was Ramsby and Campbell collide in the backfield. The ball pops into the hands of Alonzo McGee, and the Panthers have it at the Eagles' 39-yard line.
Timing is all this is right here. Going in motion. Just bad timing altogether, all around right there between the running back. I'm quite sure that Matt Breida was expecting the receiver to pass by the time he got the ball in his hands.
See Jesse Minter, the defensive coordinator, talking with Alonzo McGee, who came up with that freebie right into his hands. And I would expect the Panthers right here, right after that play, take a strike at the end zone.
Best time to do it is right here, and expect it to be down the middle of the field. That's where they've made their big plays all day.
Watch number 19, Robert Davis. He goes in motion behind the line. Play action, spin move, fire back this way. Keith Rucker was there. He was open, let it go right through his hands. Pressure coming from Darius Sapp on that play.
Georgia Southern fortunate that Keith Rucker did not catch that ball. The nearest defender was 15, 20 yards downfield. And the way he runs the ball and the skill, he runs the ball more like a fullback running back than he does a tight end. So he could have made big yards on that catch.
Second down and 10. Play action, firing to the far side. Dropped immediately, the catch by Robert Davis. And the tackle made out there by Christian Matthew. Third down coming up for the Panthers from the Eagles 35. Trying to cash in after a turnover by the Georgia Southern offense.
You haven't seen a lot of plays made by this Georgia State team, which is different because usually they make more plays on the outside to their receivers. But it's been so much green yardage in the middle of the field, especially when they go five wide receivers.
Panthers are 4 of 10 on third downs. That was Barnett in motion, and a timeout called by the Eagles. And that will leave them with two left here in the half. So Tyson Summers burns a timeout, with the Panthers facing a third and six. 2:29 to play in the quarter. Panthers on top by 10 and looking for more. Panthers firing wide after picking up the first down on third and six on the pass completion to Robert Davis, going for it there on first and 10. The pass goes incomplete. Panthers now have it at the Eagles' 27-yard line.
And this
2 minutes to play in the third quarter.
And this is when Georgia State not having a run game really hurts them. They're up by 10. They have the momentum going into their goal, possibly scoring a touchdown. Here is when you like to take the ball and run a little time off the clock on your way to scoring. Right now, all they have is a pass game, and it keeps them, you know, the clock stops, and Georgia Southern gets more chances.
Second down and 10, rolling to the right. Manning fires on the run, and Juwan Nobles can't come up with it. Bowdry applies the hit, and then a flag comes out late. I don't know that I agree with that one, Wayne. A very late flag after the hit by Bowdry.
Not just late, but you could see Bowdry pull himself away from not even completing the hit. And I think that's where he should have gotten the benefit from, that he saw, oh, the ball hit the ground, let me stop myself.
Personal foul, targeting on the defense number 27. The previous play is under further review.
Wow. I didn't think that Bowdry made any contact whatsoever with Noble's head, but we'll see on the replay.
Nobody hit the ground, and you can see the concerted effort of Jay Bowdry not to even lunge himself into this hit.
Well, they'll take a look at it right here. I was surprised because I didn't think that Bowdry made any contact with Noble's helmet, but here's a look at it yourself.
Good rollout by Connor Manning out in no man's land. He throws the ball, and Jay Bowdry never hit him in the head at all.
He hit him in the
shoulder right there and pulled off.
I mean, that is such a quick play. I don't think there shouldn't be any flag whatsoever for late hit or anything. I mean, that's just happening so fast. I mean, we're slowing it down, and you're seeing it in replay. But that is happening so fast on the field. You're almost asking a defensive back to do the impossible.
And that's the
thing. I mean, if you can't play at that speed, then offenses should score touchdowns on every play.
And the thing is, when you slow it down, it makes you feel like, oh, he had time to stop his body where he did not. It was bang, bang. He dropped the ball. He kind of went into it, and he made a concerted effort not to finish him and hit him. And you're right, Matt. I don't even see a penalty.
Yeah, there shouldn't even be a flag on that play, much less a targeting call.
After review, the ruling on the field that number 26 targeted a defenseless player is confirmed. Number 26, the defense is disqualified.
That is stunning.
It'll be a 15-yard penalty, protection half distance, automatic first down.
That is stunning.
I don't know what a defender is supposed to do at this point. Matt, I really don't understand what Mr. Bowdry was supposed to do. If you watch this in real time, as soon as the ball...
See, we're slowing it down for you.
Right, we're slowing it down, so it makes it seem like there's this long amount of time. He almost is
about
to fall.
He took one step. I mean, in his head is looking at the defender. He doesn't even really maybe know that the ball has hit the ground. And the ball was tipped. That's amazing.
I didn't even see the defender's head snap. He really hit him in the shoulder.
So the Panthers get new life here after that questionable targeting call and the ejection of Jay Bowdry. They run the ball to Glenn Smith. Let's see who's coming to the ball game for Bowdry back there. I'm guessing it's going to be 24, Sean Freeman.
And that really hurts if Georgia Southern comes back and win this game. Then Mr. Bowdry, Jay Bowdry, is out the first half of their next game against Troy, because we're in the second half now with the targeting call.
I believe Vegas Harley has taken his spot back there at safety, number 10, standing at the four-yard line, now backing up to the one. Second down and seven. Pressure coming from Oligwe. Toss to the end zone, and it's caught there by Glenn Smith, but he's out of bounds. Coverage by Christian Matthew, and it's going to be third down. Look, I'm all for player safety, and I think we got to do all our best to protect players, but I can't agree any less with that call that we just saw here on this field.
It's a back shoulder throw right here. Just ran out of real estate. Glenn Smith catching the ball, just nowhere to come down. Good defense there by the cornerback. By eating up the yardage between him and Glenn Smith, he gave him nowhere to come down with the ball.
Third down and seven from the 10-yard line. Manning off his back foot falls incomplete, and the Panthers facing fourth down from the 10.
Once again, right here with Georgia State, this is where you really wish you had some semblance of a run game, having to throw the ball three times with inside the 15-yard line, not able to have any effectiveness running the ball because run game has not been there. Having to throw the ball has put them in a bad situation.
And Brandon Wright's going to try the field goal here, so they're going to use Wright instead of 10 Lowhouse after you had made the observation that the 10 Lowhouse kicks are too low.
Yeah, they're low, the defensive lineman, just with a little penetration, not that far in the backfield, have been able to knock this ball down.
This is a 27-yard kick for Brandon Wright. And he knuckles it through. And Georgia State takes a 13-point lead on the 27-yard kick by Brandon Wright. That had been one of the issues on the PAT and the blocked field goal, that the kicks were low to begin with.
And that's a lot of pressure for Brandon Wright to go in and knock that in with the previous two field goal attempts being blocked. And you're the punter or the kickoff person to try to go in and kick a field goal. And as you saw, he quickly got it in the net with the knuckleball.
So Tyson Summers over there talking to the officials. They are looking, he is looking, no doubt, for an explanation, or at least trying to make his case. Jay Bowdry had been the leading tackler for the Eagles today with seven total tackles. He has been ejected from the game during that drive, a targeting penalty that gave the Panthers a first down and ultimately led to their 27-yard field goal that gives them a 30-17 lead.
And hopefully Coach Summers can send this in and they will repeal it and bring Bowdry back for the next game. But right now with the ejection, he would have to sit out the first half of the next game. So hopefully he can submit this just like a team can submit a play and get a player that wasn't called for a penalty set out in the first half of the next game.
And, of course, that happened to Georgia State this past week when Trey Payne, who was not flagged for a hit in the second half of the UL Monroe game, it was later reviewed and was suspended for the first half of this game. And the Eagles playing without two players, two starters now in their secondary. Darius Jones, the cornerback, out with a shoulder injury. And now Jay Bowdry has been ejected. And Brandon Wright, who just kicked the field goal, is going to kick off for the Panthers. Quan Howard retreating to the two-yard line. Howard, what a hit as he collides at the 24-yard line. Big hit by the Panthers right there. And Antrell Allen.
Looks like he's a little dazed, Andrew Allen.
That's Javonte Lane.
Oh. hitting goes both ways. Sometimes a lot of people that's never been out on the field, delivering a hit can knock yourself out trying to hit someone, and especially in the special teams game. K Kevin Ellison back on the field, Matt. Let's see if we can keep him on the field this time. He's been in and out of the lineup today.
So first and 10, under a minute to play here in the third quarter. Handoff goes to Breida. And Breida picks up 8 yards up to the 33-yard line. Alonzo McGee making the tackle for the Panthers. As the Eagles find themselves down by 13 points again. They had fallen behind by 20 in the first 8 minutes of this game, had cut it back to 3 by the end of the first half, and now they've been outscored 10-0 here in the third quarter by Georgia State. Second down and 1. Breida gets it again, picks up the first down. Breida across the 40, 45. Breida steps out of bounds across the 50 at the 47.
And you can see after this run, Kevin Ellison still gingerly walking down the field. He seems that even handing the ball off is hurting his back right there. And Matt Breida and this offensive line are going to have to take control of this game.
They've got to keep Ellison in this ball game. The offense has been so much better with him running it. Hurt or not, first and 10 from the 47. Ellison going to pump fake and run it. And Ellison gets double tagged at the 44-yard line. Everett in on that tackle.
That's the end of the third quarter.
And that is the end of the third quarter. So Georgia State and Georgia Southern in the third all-time meeting between these budding Sun Belt rivals. Winner will take the early lead in the all-time series. And right now, the Panthers with a 13-point lead as we head to the fourth quarter. Start of the fourth quarter, and Favian Upshaw begins the quarter for the Eagles as he gets it inside the 40-yard line on that carry right there. So again, Ellison banged up. We've seen him hurt his ankle, hurt his back here today. And at the end of the quarter, unable to begin this fourth quarter. It's third down and 3 for the Eagles at the 40-yard line.
Big third down for Georgia Southern, something they haven't had a lot of success, especially when it's been third and long. Right here is third and makeable.
Third down. Ramsby in trouble. Shaw going to drop him for a loss back at the 46. Okay, Wayne, you're facing a fourth down at 9. Do you punt it here and try to pin Georgia State deep, or do you go for it?
You have to punt the ball right here and trust your defense to try to get off the field a 3-and-out. Right there, Favian Upshaw just showing no patience in handing the ball to L.A. Ramsey, and the defense never was faked out, and the defensive end never had to buy the play fake because he gave him the ball so fast.
So Flynn standing at his own 40 to kick. Cedric Stone deep for the Panthers. Line drive kick. Stone slides and catches it at the 13-yard line. And the Panthers will be on offense, first and 10, at their own 13 here early in the fourth quarter. So Panthers go back on offense, first and 10 at their own 14-yard line. Matt Stewart and Wayne Gandy with you at the Georgia Dome. Handoff goes to Kirk, and DeMarcus Kirk gets dropped at the 18-yard line by Ironhead Gallon.
Georgia State really needs to find a way to run the ball, whether it's with Glenn or Neal, to try to eat up some clock. The clock is now your friend. You're up 13 points. If you can go on a 6-7 minute drive, even if it results in no points, you put a lot of pressure on a team that doesn't like to throw the ball.
Panthers only have 57 yards rushing in the game. Handoff goes to Kirk again, and not much doing. Gallon there again as Kirk is stopped at the 19-yard line. Jay Ellison in on that tackle as well for the Eagles, and now it's going to be third down and medium for the Panthers. Georgia State, 2-8. Their season will come to a close in two Saturdays when they play at Idaho. Head coach Trent Miles dismissed on Sunday. Tim Lapano, the wide receivers coach, the interim for the final two games. And the Panthers trying to spoil the bowl eligibility chances of the Georgia Southern Eagles. They would do that with their win today, if they're able to get the win today. Manning back to pass, firing wide open. Keith Rucker for the first down, and still on his feet out across the 40-yard line. Keith Rucker with his 7th catch of the day.
Seventh catch of the day. Fifth in the middle of the field has been Keith Rucker. Right now, really leading this team, making plays. And as I said, he runs the ball more like a fullback than he does a tight end. When he gets the ball in his hands, if you watch him run the ball, it's very physical and very fullbackish. Is number 45, Keith Rucker.
With his 137 yards of receiving today, Rucker has gone over 1,000 for his career. Oligwe is hurt. Oligwe being helped off the field as we take a look at the Sun Belt scoreboard. UL Lafayette playing out of conference today. They were losers at Georgia 35-21. App State 35-10 lead on UL Monroe in the third quarter. A victory there by the Mountaineers would eliminate the Warhawks from bowl eligibility. South Alabama playing that substitute game with Presbyterian. They were scheduled to be playing LSU today. Of course, LSU had to reschedule with Florida, and Florida won today to clinch the SEC Eastern Division.
I wonder if the Tigers of Baton Rouge had to cough over some money to get to South Alabama.
Oh, no doubt. Manning back to pass, looking, firing over on the far sideline and cannot connect. Robert Davis, the intended target. He's only been able to team up, well, I say only, four catches, 76 yards, and a touchdown for Robert Davis today. That's a pretty good day for most.
Pretty good day, but not for Robert Davis. But in this game, as we have talked about all night, all day long, the middle
holding
of the field has just been
defense,
open.
Defense, number 13, 10-yard penalty from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
Christian Matthew, the corner, called for holding on Robert Davis, and that will give the Panthers a first down across the 50-yard line. They'll spot it at the Eagles 46.
Most of the big plays for this offense has come from something down the hash marks in this game between Connor Manning and Keith Rucker or Glenn Smith. They've really exposed that the linebackers of Georgia Southern are not very good covering in space.
First and 10, Kyler Neal gets the handoff. Neal bulls his way into Joshua Moon, who finally gets him on the ground after a 5-yard pickup at the 41-yard line and another flag out at the 47.
Holding, offense number 45, 10-yard penalty, still first down.
That's Rucker, the tight end, who's had a great day receiving, but that time flagged for the hold.
In these situations, penalties are so big. You have some momentum. You're on your side of the field. You're up 13. You're just trying to keep a drive going, eat up some clock, and that puts you off your timing. Now it's benefit is third down, puts you in a situation where balls get batted and intercepted, and Georgia State has to figure out a way to run this ball and be effective.
First down and 20 with the ball at the 44. High snap. Manning corrals it, throws complete. That's Rucker again with his eighth catch of the day. And he gets back across the 50-yard line down to the 49. William Bussey making the tackle for the Eagles.
Keith Rucker said, I'll make up for my holding penalty by getting that 10 yards back. Got eight of them. He has been playing well today, the senior, on senior day here in the Georgia Dome.
Rucker having a career day in his final game in a Georgia State uniform here in this building, the Georgia Dome. Second down and 12. That's Glenn Smith who makes the grab. Gets down at the 39-yard line. That's going to leave the Panthers about 3 yards short of the first down.
Glenn Smith, one thing about him today, he's shown you that he has no problem going amongst the big trees in the middle and catching the ball. Usually receivers like to work outside the numbers. He's done most of his work today inside the numbers.
Third down and 3 for the Panthers. They are 6 of 13 on third downs today. Firing low for Robert Davis at the 34-yard line, and it's going to be fourth down for the Panthers. Do you punt here, or do you go for it on fourth and 3?
I would take the gamble and go for it, but not a bad decision to punt. Put them deep. Their offense is not really built to go in the air, so making them go to long field running the ball is your advantage to you, Georgia State. The question is, can you get the kickoff They've had a lot of issues in the special teams.
Oliver Holdenson from Melbourne, Australia, on to punt for the Panthers at the 45-yard line. Left-footed kick. He angles end over end. Going to hit at the 14 and be down by Rucker at the 13. So effective play for the Panthers on the punt as they put the Eagles down inside their own 20-yard line. Time running out on Georgia Southern. They're down two scores with 10 minutes to play. 10 minutes, 7 seconds left. Georgia State on top, 30-17. Fabian Upshaw still in there at quarterback, and he's going to scramble and go down at the 19-yard line. Martarius Allen making the tackle for the Panthers after a close to 5-yard pickup. Now, Wayne Gandy, what would you do offensively if you're the Eagles? This is not a great comeback team or comeback style of offense team.
I probably would switch out quarterbacks, put Schumann in. He's more of a passing quarterback. Every time the Upshaw's in, even when he seems like he's about to make a play, something breaks down, he goes to run. And Georgia State, their back end of their defense, if you see them, they're not coming up. They're not coming off their receiver, so that's why he can't find anything to throw to.
You saw him throw low right there to Monte Crockett. I couldn't agree with you more. I mean, Upshaw's had some great games for Georgia Southern, but his timing just isn't there right now.
Yeah, 7 games out. Right now, the best thing he knows to do is run. That's his instinct. But right now, this team is in a passing situation.
Fires. That's complete to Miles Campbell at the 21-yard line, but it's going to be short of the first down. Let's see where they spot it. It looks like they're giving him a really good spot at the 23. That might be a first down. Shandon Sullivan made the tackle for the Panthers, but you see the spot at the 23, so it's very close. Tyson Summers over there motioning that they got the first down. The officials are going to measure here. I thought when Miles Campbell caught the ball that he was short, but the spot is much better than I thought it would be. And so he is close to a first down there at the 23 as they bring the sticks across.
Yeah, from our angle, when he caught the ball, he was short. It seemed like they gave him a good extra half a yard.
I thought he caught it at the 21 myself, but they've spotted it at the 23. He's picked up the first down by the length of the football. Let's take a look at the replay. Where does he catch this thing?
Even right here, good protection, a little pressure. It was more around the 22, it seems like.
He caught it in the air and was driven back in the air, so they gave him forward motion, and they said his forward motion was the 23 and good enough for the first down. So a big pickup there for the Eagles to keep the sticks moving. First and 10 from the 23. Panthers back out of the blitz. It's thrown complete to B.J. Johnson, and he's up to the 35-yard line for a first down. Bobby Baker making the tackle for the Panthers, and that'll move the sticks again.
Fabian Upshaw, who we have said has been out most of the season. Even on regular, simple throws, he seems like he's a little jittery, a little happy feet. Really want to rush and get the ball out of his hands.
Flag out. Pre-snap penalty here.
False start. Offense. Number 9. 5-yard penalty. Still first down.
Monte Crockett, the wide receiver. So first and 15 from the 29. We're down to 8 minutes and 50 seconds to play. Upshaw going to run for it. Gets by one man and another gets to the outside. Nearly lost the ball as the tackle was made by Middleton. He nearly stripped him as Upshaw gets close to the first down at the 41-yard line.
Only rushing 3 and dropping 9 is Georgia State. Fabian Upshaw, his first instinct is to run, trying to make hay doing that. But they really need to get some plays down the field. Everything is in front of Georgia State's defense.
Second down and 3. Upshaw slings it to the outside, and that's a first down catch by Hamp McConnell. Michael Shaw making the tackle. Hamp McConnell, who came to Georgia Southern as a quarterback out of West Forsyth High School here in the Atlanta area, moved to wide receiver when it became apparent he wasn't going to be in the quarterback mix. That's a catch for him right there. Had a big game against UL Lafayette two Thursday nights ago, and movement, pre-snap penalty here on the Eagles. That's the second time in the last couple of snaps they've had a false start.
Number 78.
They're only rushing three, which is very interesting in this situation, because all day long they was getting pressure with four rushers and dropping the seven defenders. Now they're more in a three-man rush, prevent defense. These tackles get itchy out on the end. I know it's a little crowded in here, but you got to sit in there and be disciplined. These are the kind of plays that throw your timing off, and now you're in first and long.
First and 15 now. Second time they've faced a first and 15. Caught at the 48-yard line by Crockett as they get 6.5 of it back.
Georgia Southern still doesn't seem to be at a pace of really trying to get down the field and fast. They got to get this ball off, and because you want to be able to just kick the ball off. You don't want to have to go onside kick. So you want to score quick so you can kick regular down the field.
Upshaw going on the far sideline, broken up. B.J. Johnson the target. Brian Williams and Jerome Smith on the coverage for the Panthers.
Really the first time we've been able to call Jerome Smith's name out today for something down the field. Georgia Southern has been underneath throwing the ball all day. Right here, just ball hawking, coming across the field as Brian Williams almost picking the ball off.
Yeah, Jerome Smith, pardon me, did have a quarterback sack earlier in the day, the only one for the Panthers. Third down and 9 for Georgia Southern. We're down to 7:06 to play. Firing, it's caught for a first down by Quan Howard. Howard down to the 33-yard line, and a first down catch for the Eagles and a flag out. We might have a roughing the passer tacked on at the end of this play.
Personal foul, targeting defense number 44. It's a 15-yard penalty with an automatic first down. The previous play is under further review.
Not only roughing the passer, but targeting on Michael Shaw.
Which would be a big loss for this defense. He is one of their key playmakers. Coming up the middle on the late. Kind of hard to see whether it's helmet to helmet. He didn't leave his feet. He didn't dive on the quarterback. He didn't go low. Only thing they could have is possibly his helmet.
Yeah, I thought the helmet was contact. You see, pointing to the shoulder pads, that's what I thought. Yeah. He said you could see him motioning. I hit him with my face mask on his shoulder pads. That's the argument that he's making. I'm becoming the world's worst judge on this. I didn't think there was targeting on Bowdry, and I don't think there's targeting on Shaw right there either. But I don't know anymore.
Yeah, it's a truly subjective view, and they're giving it, trying to protect the players, and rightfully so. But the caution of any time that an offensive player is hit, to always think that it is targeting, is just not doing any justice for the defense. Because I think on both plays, Matt, if you watch them, it's hard to even see the personal foul. It's not even – it's questionable even for it to be a late hit.
Yeah, well, I mean, the officials in college football are trying to do the right thing. They're trying to eliminate hits to the opponent's helmet, and they're trying to eliminate the defenders using their helmets to protect them as well, and not just protect the offensive player, but the defensive player as well. The problem is, in college football, it's such a high-intensity, high-impact, high-speed sport. Invariably, you're going to have some of those things.
Yeah, if you tell
and
them.
And a lot of times, and maybe most of the time, they're not intentional.
Non-intentional.
It just happens.
And you can't just stop your body. Yeah. These guys are bigger and faster, and you try to go out and run and stop in one step. You can't do that.
After review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. Number 44 of the defense is disqualified.
Well, you saw that coming, because if Baldry was ejected, then Shaw certainly had to be ejected too. And I really don't agree with either call. And again, I understand, I'm not criticizing the officials. They're following the letter of the law to the fullest extent. And we need to protect the players, I know that. But at some point, I think there needs to be intent involved here. I mean, if it's intentional, then yes. But it's a high-speed, high-collision sport, and sometimes these kind of things just happen. But anyway, enough on that. It's a first and 10 for the Eagles at the 18-yard line.
And the biggest part is being ejected in the second half, yeah, as you sit out the next half of the next game.
Upshaw, back to pass and throws complete to Campbell. Campbell tripped up at the 14-yard line by Stone. Pickup of 4 on the play. That, to me, that's the big thing, I think, going forward. I mean, there needs to be malicious intent, especially if you're talking about an ejection that's going to carry into the next game.
And when you're talking about trying to, the intent has to be the part that I think has to be looked at more. Was he really intentionally trying to hit the person?
Ball is caught inside the 10-yard line. Monte Crockett, that's going to move the sticks, and a first and goal to go coming up for the Eagles. Bobby Baker making that tackle for the Panthers. But both of these teams have lost critical and key defenders today to that penalty call.
And if Georgia Southern comes back to win this game, as we spoke about earlier, losing one of their top defenders for the first half of the Troy game will be big.
First and goal to go. Breida gets the handoff, and Breida going to be stopped at the 5-yard line. Trey Payne, who had to sit out the first half of this ball game after a penalty, had been noticed on the film in the last ball game. He made that tackle playing here in the second half, and a man down for the Panthers as well. That's Alonzo McGee, their leading tackler and linebacker.
His right arm, maybe his rotator cuff. Georgia Southern still doesn't seem to be at a tempo to try to get in the end zone. I understand trying to make sure, but you got to save some time. You don't want to have the onside kick. You want to be able to stop them, get the ball back, and still be able to get down the field.
Well, let me ask you this, Wayne. How much of it is their tempo and intentionality, and how much is it the way Georgia State's playing them on defense to keep them from up-tempo and scoring quickly?
Well, it seems that even with Fabian Upshaw, a different quarterback trying to throw the ball, it seems that they, because at times early in the game, they were moving fast. They were in and out of the huddle. He seems not to be getting the plays in. And remember, we said he's been out 7 weeks, so the plays don't seem to be flowing in and out to him as fast as it was when Kevin Ellison was out there.
Well, I think the point that you made a few moments ago is very valid because of the length of this drive. Let's assume that Georgia Southern does score here. I think it's probably going to be around the 5-minute mark or less when they do. So now you're facing a very important question. Do you onside kick after you score the touchdown, or do you kick away and try to, pin Georgia State deep and get a good stop on defense and get the ball back that way?
Based on that, your offense is not one of those, I can get a touchdown in 2 minutes. It's not one of those kind of offenses. It's more run-based, short yardage throws. So you want to give them as much time as possible, and that's why they need to go ahead on in the next play or two and get in the end zone.
Alonzo McGee still slow to get off the field, yet to clear the field. As the Eagles have it, second down and goal to go from the 5-yard line. You see him wincing in pain and favoring that right arm and right shoulder. So back to business here, 5:39 and the clock rolling again. Upshaw throws to Campbell. Campbell one man to beat and not going to be able to get in. Shandon Sullivan stopped him at the 2-yard line, and the clock will continue to run as he was down before he went out of bounds.
Nice play right there, tackle. To keep him out of the end zone, but most importantly, kept the clock rolling. The clock is becoming Georgia Southern's enemy right here.
Third down and goal from the 2-yard line. Ramsby in there at running back, and they'll give it to him. No, Upshaw's going to keep it. He will not get in. Great stop by Trey Payne, and then he comes up with the ball. And there's a flag down. Let's see if there was a fumble. Was the ball down? Let's check the flag. Lots of things to look at right here. I think we have an offsides on the Panthers. At least if I read the body language of one of the officials right. The other question, was
offside,
it a fumble?
Right, I was about to say, if it wasn't offsides and it was a fumble, who recovered the ball?
Offside, defense, yeah. Number 33 lined up in the neutral zone, half the distance to the goal, still third down.
So James Traylor, the linebacker, lined up in the neutral zone. If there was a fumble, then that was negated right there. And now it's going to be third down and goal from the 1 yard line for the Eagles. Handoff, Ramsby, touchdown. L.A. Ramsby rams it in from 1 yard out. And the Eagles back on the board as they cut the Panthers' lead to 7 with 4:42 to play.
Ramsby's 8th rushing touchdown to lead this team in rushing touchdowns this year. Just off tackle. Big offensive line just blocking down, knock everybody down. Big 96 in there in their 12 formation and making a touchdown for L.A. Ramsey.
14 plays, 87 yards. It took 5:25 off the clock. The PAT makes it a 6-point game. And remember, the Panthers had a PAT blocked in the first quarter. It could come back to be a big factor here in this ballgame. 4:42 to play in this ballgame. Georgia Southern has cut the Georgia State lead to 30-24. And a play by number 92, Jonathan Battle, Wayne, way back in the first 5 minutes of this game, may come back to be a huge play in this game.
Extra point right here, just pushing up the middle, about 300-pounders in one hole, just pushing the guard back, low kick, and Jonathan Battle getting that big mitt on it and knocking it down.
And that's the reason why the Panthers' lead right now is 6 and not 7.
And now here comes Georgia State's offense. We've talked all day about not being able to run the ball. Here's one of those situations where you really need to put 2 or 3 first downs on the ground, stay in bounds, safe throws if you have to do that, and milk this clock.
Tyler Bass to kick off for the Eagles. Looks like they're going to kick away. At least the Panthers think so. And they will. Trey Barnett will not return this one. And so the Panthers have it at the 25-yard line. And, Wayne, you are right on the money. The Panthers have to be able to run the ball here, you would think, in order to kill some clock. Maybe move it out a little bit and flip the field.
Kill clock and move the ball. That's the one thing. Put them in a bad situation, even if you have to punt. Put this offense that is a methodical offense in Georgia Southern in a situation where they have no timeouts and a couple of seconds to get down the field. That's your job right now if you're Georgia State.
Panthers are averaging only 3.1 yards per carry today, 62 total yards on the ground. First and 10 from the 25. Kyler Neal going to get the rock. And Neal's going to pick up a solid 5, maybe 6 yards on the play before being tackled by Logan Hunt.
The entire second half, when they have tried to run the ball, they learned that you're not going to be able to move Darius Sapp and Jonathan Battle and Jay Ellis in the middle. You're going to have to get out on the edge right there. Top Kyler Neal taking the ball on a little sweep and getting outside.
He got 6 on that play. It's 2nd down and 4. The Panthers burning as much time as possible. You see, there's still 13 on the play clock. You can see the red number clicking down. Panthers get it inside 5 and now snap it with 3. Neal the run, and Neal up to the 34-yard line. Gallon making the tackle. He's going to be about a yard short of the first down. This is a big third down coming up for the Eagles defense and the Panthers offense.
Good job by this offense. This is what you wanted. You know, first two runs, milk some clock, create third and one. This is a situation that you want to be in. Convert this. You get another set of downs to run another 2 minutes off the clock, or at least force Georgia Southern to call a timeout.
Well, if the Eagles don't stop them here, they'll have to start using their timeouts on defense. Play clock is at 7. Neal gets it again and did not get the first down. How about that? Oligwe coming up with the big hit. I don't think he got the first down. Maybe with the initial effort he did. They spotted at the 35, and if that's the case, he did get the first down. I thought Oligwe had stopped him, but maybe it was a second effort here.
That's a big, tough run right here on the trap play. Oligwe is trying to push him back. They gave him forward progress on the play.
I thought Oligwe had hit him and stopped him at the 34, but maybe the body lean by Kyler Neal in the aftermath of that hit got him the first down at the 35.
I think Coach Summers here is asking for
a review.
A review.
Prior to the timeout by Georgia Southern, we were paged by the replay booth to review the previous play.
Well, that's good for Georgia Southern. You know, just to me watching the play in live time, I didn't think he got to the 35 ever.
I think when he failed, when the league way hit him, he was able to spin out of it. He wasn't on the ground yet. So right there, and he spins. He's still up.
Yeah, well, there definitely.
And now he's down.
With the spin and the fall forward,
right,
there's no doubt he picked up the first down. The question is, did the whistle ever blow? And I guess it didn't.
Yeah,
and that's the one thing that we don't know.
Correct.
Is did the whistle blow? Because Oligwe definitely makes contact at the 34.
Right,
it looks
there,
like they have him stopped right there.
He's not down. He's on top of a player.
You're right. He's sitting on top of Joshua Moon right there. Oligwe hits him at the 34. Joshua Moon comes in to help pull him down. He falls on top of Moon, so he's not down yet. And then he is able with his body to fall forward to the 35-yard line. And if they stick with that, that's a first down.
Without a whistle, if he's on top of Moon, the play is still going. And sometimes, especially as a defender, you don't know that. You just know he's down on the ground. But if there's no whistle, that's a conversion of a first down. Right there.
And I think it is going to be a first down. I don't think they're going to have
after
enough
review,
evidence to bring it back.
The field stands. Yep. It is a first down.
I don't think the replay official, John Lane, had any recourse but to change that call. I mean, to not change the call. He didn't have evidence to overturn it.
And Oligwe, with him being on top of Moon, he thinks he's on the ground, but he's not. And that little wiggle at the end gave Kyler Neal that first down.
So first and 10 for the Panthers, and now the Eagles are in that territory where they're going to have to start burning their last two timeouts. And the Panthers are close to that territory where another first down wins this game. We're getting close to that. Panthers letting the clock run all the way down on the play clock before they snap it. They snap it with 4 and give it to Kyler Neal. And Neal gets 3 on the play. Trey Griffin was the first guy to hit him. And let's see if they burn the timeout here. They haven't done it yet. I think they're going to let it run on through right now. They gave him 2 on the play. It's 2nd down and 8.
Offensive line, you cut your split down to about a foot. You stay low. You keep your hands inside because the one thing that can hurt you right now is a holding penalty. And you just push. And as a running back, you cover the ball with 2 hands, and you just keep your legs churning forward.
Eagles will have to burn a timeout after this next play. Hand off Neal, not going anywhere. Expect the timeout. There it is. Oligwe got him. Dropped him at the 35-yard line.
Georgia Southern, that's their 2nd timeout of the half.
Stops the clock with 1 minute and 36 seconds.
It'll be a 30-second timeout.
The Eagles have 1 more timeout to burn, and they will do it after this 3rd down play. And if they can hold the Panthers from getting a first down, they're going to get the ball back. If the Panthers get a first down, the game's going to be over.
And the big decision is, do I try to get the first down or do I run the ball and try to make them burn their last timeout so when I do punt the ball, They will have less than a minute with this kind of offense, right, which is run-heavy offense.
And we might see the freshman Schumann come in if they get that opportunity. They haven't gotten to that point yet where they get that opportunity. Wayne, what would you do? You're not going to run 10 yards for a first down here, so would you pass it?
I would run the ball.
You'd run.
I would make them burn their last time out, and I would put the pressure on them to have to go that far to score a touchdown.
I agree with you.
They don't need a field goal. They have to go and get a touchdown.
Yep. I agree with you.
Less than a minute to go in the game.
Third down and 10. Let's see if Oligwe and this Georgia Southern Eagles defense can get the ball back for their offense. Noble's in motion behind the line. Handoff goes to Glenn Smith. He's going to be stopped, and the Eagles will use their last timeout right there. Stops the clock with 1:31.
Georgia Southern, that's their final timeout of the half. This will be a 30-second timeout.
Only 5 seconds burn off there. The Eagles are going to get it back unless they make a mistake on special teams. They got to be very careful about that, not to rough the kicker. And they're going to get it back. Now, the next question, assuming they are going to get the ball back here, no mistakes, nothing crazy happens, do you bring in Schumann, the freshman, the passing quarterback, to run this team the final 90 seconds of this game?
I would put Schumann in the game because I need to be able to get this ball down the field vertically. And right now, Upshaw is more of going to tuck it and run and try to get the first down if any trouble comes up. Georgia State have put themselves in a great position because, to me, this team, when it does win, the success that it has had this year has come from the defense. So let's put my best defense out here to stop your offense.
Brandon Wright on to punt for the Panthers. He's standing at his 24. Remember, the Panthers have been shaky in their special teams the last three games. Snap goes all the way back, and a nice booming kick by Wright, one of his best of the day. Crockett, chance to return from the 13. Crockett, oh, that might be an illegal block right there. Flag is out. Flag is out. Crockett still on his feet. We're going to have a block, an illegal block at the 10-yard line. And if the Eagles are going to come down this field and score, they're going to have to go 90-plus yards to do it.
And in some cases, you want to just fair catch that because you, by running that play and with Crockett running around,
he burned 17 seconds
off the clock.
You burned 17
on one
seconds.
Play.
You would have been better off just to let it hit and take your chances.
Yes.
Of course, that's
– or fair catch the ball and run the offense.
Yeah, that's 20-20 vision hindsight right there, but it would have been much better just to fair catch it or let it hit and bounce because now you've burned 17 seconds.
During the return, illegal block in the back. Number 82 of the receiving team, half the distance of the goal from the spot of the foul, first down.
Mike Summers, the receiver, called for the penalty. And they have Fabian Upshaw out there to run the offense.
Right here would have got the ball on the 12. Without burning really any time off the clock. In that situation, if you are on the return team, you don't block, you just shield, almost like setting a pick. Stand there and let the defender run into you.
Eagles have to go 96 yards in 1 minute and 14 seconds. They have no timeouts remaining. Upshaw back to pass, firing across the middle. That's complete. Another flag is out. Ransby caught the ball at the 10, but another penalty flag, and this likely on the Eagles. They lost another 7 seconds right there. Although Georgia Southern thinks it's on Georgia State.
Ineligible receiver downfield. On the offense, number 83 was lined up on the line of scrimmage and was covered up. Half the distance to the goal from the previous spot, it's still first down.
Wow, that's Keegan Williams who's flagged on the play. Now they got to go 98 yards. And now they have seven less seconds to do it. Things are getting worse, not better, for Georgia Southern.
And they really need something vertically going down the field. These underneath passes are not going to get you down the field fast enough.
Upshaw stands in there, slings it downfield, broken up at the 25-yard line. Cedric Stone, the freshman cornerback, with a big play right there, and now it's second down.
Nice play by Stone, getting back and getting that arm in there, never giving up on the play. This is an impressive secondary that Georgia State puts on the field, regardless who's out there.
Second down and 12, down to 57 seconds to play. Georgia State trying to beat Georgia Southern for for the second consecutive year and knocked them out of contention for bowl eligibility. Upshaw going to run across the 5, the 10, the 15, picks up the first down out of bounds at the 17-yard line. Down to 49 seconds. That gets them some running room and some breathing room and operating room, but they still got a long way to go, 83 yards away.
Georgia State, this defense, best in the Sun Belt, hasn't given up a 5 pass touchdowns all season. Bobby Baker, Shannon Sullivan, Jerome Smith, top-notch secondary as Upshaw has to score against.
Upshaw goes this way and nearly intercepted at the 32-yard line. Quan Howard, the intended target, and Bobby Baker nearly got the pick. You just hate it for the Georgia Southern Eagles that Kevin Ellison wasn't able to complete the day. He was playing well.
He was doing what they came in here to do, which was to run the ball against his team, and him getting banged up both times that he had to leave the game really put them behind.
Ankle and then a back injury. The back injury finally took him out at the end of the third quarter. Upshaw, incomplete. Crockett the target. Now it's third down and 10.
Once again, just not able to get the ball down the field. Even if the pass is complete, it's an 8-yard catch. The time is running off the clock. You got to get something down the field.
You're right. No verticality whatsoever. No really vertical threat whatsoever from this Georgia Southern offense.
You haven't seen a receiver really behind any of these defenders all day long.
Third down and 10. Clock at 40 seconds. Eagles have no timeouts remaining. Heavy rush. Cherador brings the pressure, and it's going to be fourth down. Cherador came untouched off the left edge and nearly leveled Upshaw. Made him throw it early. It's fourth down.
I think the right tackle felt like John Freeman felt like Cherador might have jumped off sides on that play. But you still got to play the play and let the referee make the call. He just stopped and let Cherador go free into the backfield.
Eagles got to pick up 10 here or Georgia State's going to win the game. Upshaw scrambling, in trouble, throws downfield, incomplete, and the Georgia State Panthers are going to defeat the Georgia Southern Eagles in the final game ever for GSU here at the Georgia Dome. And the Gatorade bucket for interim head coach Tim Lapano.
What a great feeling that Tim Lapano and Georgia State and their fans, after losing last week and firing the coach to come out here against your rival, your budding new rival in the Sun Belt to win at home last game here, says a lot for this program.
And you know, Trent Miles has got to be smiling somewhere. These are his guys, even though he got fired. I thought he was incredibly gracious and professional in the article where he was, you know, questioned about the firing by the Atlanta Journal-Constitution. He took the high road on every question. I thought he handled it great. And, you know he hated not to be here today. But congratulations to the Georgia State Panthers and Trent Miles' kids for picking up a big 30-24 victory over Georgia Southern this afternoon as the Panthers take a 2-1 lead in this budding Sun Belt rivalry. Final seconds clicking off the clock. Tim Lapano, the interim head coach for the Georgia State Panthers, now 1-0 with a 30-24 victory over Georgia Southern. And time now to salute our Capital One Impact Performance. And it is Panthers tight end Keith Rucker with 8 catches and 145 yards receiving today.
8 catches, but they were big
motion
catches. They were big chunks of yards. Manning starting the game right here with a 34-yard reception, and you could tell he was engaged. He's the senior tight end. Every time he touched the ball, he was trying to make a lot of yards after the catch, running hard. 8 receptions, 145 yards. Keith Rucker and this Georgia State offense really showed up today.
A sweet victory for the Georgia State Panthers as they pick up their third win of the season, their second in the Sun Belt, and at the same time, they knock their rivals, the Georgia Southern Eagles, out of bowl eligibility.
Coach Miles, unfortunately, being fired and trying to build his program and a lot of things that he will get credit for, especially with the players that he brought here, things that they needed. Hats off to you for the job that you did while here. Coach Lupano, a great start for him here. Last game here in the Georgia Dome for Georgia State.
Final game of the Dome ever for Georgia State. They'll close their season in 2 weeks at Idaho as they pick up their third win of the season today with a 30-24 victory over their arch rivals, the Georgia Southern Eagles. To watch this entire game on replay, as well as other games on our family of ESPN networks, log on to watchESPN.com or download the Watch ESPN app. And now for Wayne Gandy and the entire ESPN team, I'm Matt Stewart. So long from the Georgia Dome, where the Panthers beat the Eagles 30-24. This has been a presentation of ESPN.